Blog Talk Radio.
Mr. Noel Ignatiev. Are you with us, sir?
Yes, I am. How do you do?
I am well, sir. How are you?
I'm fine.
Thank you. I want to thank you again for taking time out of your busy schedule to speak with our listeners today and share constructive information about racism, white supremacy, sir.
Well, it's a pleasure to be here.
Thank you.
At least I hope it will be.
I hope so, too, more than anything. I hope we'll have a constructive conversation, and our listeners and myself can learn a lot that will be helpful in our understanding of racism. And will give us some suggestions on things we can do to replace white supremacy with justice. I guess to get started, if you could...
Before you go any further, would you mind giving me an idea? How much time have you allotted for our conversation?
The program, well, I don't know where you are, but I believe I sent an email. It was 1 to 3 Eastern.
Okay. That gives me.
Okay. If you could share with our listeners who may not have read your book or checked out your website, if you could share with them, I guess just any constructive information about your background, who you are, so they get a better idea of who you are speaking with us today.
Well, my background is what I am. I am what is conventionally called white in this country, although it's not a designation that I particularly wish to embrace. My grandparents were born in Europe. My parents were born in the United States. I am American-born. I worked for many, many years in steel mills and farm equipment plants around the Midwest and elsewhere. And then I went to school. I grew up in Philadelphia, and then I went to school and got a doctorate and became an instructor and wrote a book and have done some other things. So... I was an activist. I tried to be active in the movements of the 60s against Vietnam and against white supremacy. And so, you know, that ought to give you some idea of my background.
Before I ask about your work against racism, white supremacy, and things that you've written, I wanted to make sure I have your permission to ask you questions dealing with all areas of racism, white supremacy, education, entertainment, labor, law, politics, religion, sex, war, and economics.
You certainly have my permission to ask any question you like. If I can answer it, I will, and if not, I won't.
Okie dokie. That'll work. And you said you are a white person, correct?
Well, I'm what the society calls a white person. That is, I am of European descent, and I am not made to sit in the back of the bus. In Georgia, I look like a white person. It seems to me that that's, no one is born white. People are made white by the society they live in. If I had been in Europe, I'd have been known as Polish or Russian or German or Irish or something like that, and I would not have been thought of as white. It's only because of the situation, the importance that this society attaches to color, that I become white. It's not a choice that I didn't choose to be. I was just born like anybody else without any say in how I was going to be put into the society. So that's a short answer, a long answer to a short question.
Just to be clear, but you said you are a white person?
No, I didn't say I am a white person. I said I am what this society calls a white person.
Okay. Do you classify as a white person when you fill out forms?
I try not to. I do my best. I do not like to put down on those forms anything about race. I go along with James Baldwin. You know, white is an invented identity. White is a social identity. I mean, I don't mind telling people what I look like. I'm 6 feet tall, olive complexion, Mediterranean, brown hair, hazel eyes. That's how I look. Not as much hair as I used to have. Gray, more gray than brown now. But no, I don't like to think of myself as a white person. They're outside of a social context. There are no white persons or black persons. I mean, there are obviously people who look different, and I'm certainly on the fairer side of the human spectrum so far as color is concerned, but white and black are social designations.
the name of this program, The Cows, Context of White Supremacy, I have taken the position that we are in a global system of racism, white supremacy, and the definition that I use for white supremacy is a global system of people who classify themselves as white and are dedicated to mistreating and or subjugating everyone in the known universe whom they classify as not white. Do you believe that, such a system does exist?
Oh, I do. I think that that's a useful definition. I do not classify myself as white, and I am not subject. I am not seek to subjugate people classified as non-white. The problem is I don't have very much say over it at all. I'm really not in charge of anything. But yes, I think that that's a useful definition of a system of white supremacy. But what do you do about a person like me? I mean, after all, years ago, I think it was Thurgood Marshall, they asked him, what is a Negro? Well, as today we would say, black person. And he said, well, a Negro is a person who has to sit in the back of the bus in Georgia. There is no other definition. Now, by that definition, I would not have had to sit in the back of the bus in Georgia. My skin color would not have put me in the back of the bus. On the other hand, I didn't make those laws. I do my best to not follow them, to resist them, to oppose them. But so even though I'm not dedicated, I'm certainly opposed to the system of white supremacy as you describe it. Nevertheless, I enjoy whatever the benefits are of being white in this society, more or less. Not because I choose to, but because it's out of my control, for the most part. For the most part. Does that make sense?
Well, hopefully we'll get clarity, so we shall see. We will get clarity as we roll. It has been my experience that non-white people tend to be a little confused about racism, white supremacy, including myself, part of our victimization, I feel. I have found it is helpful in discussions of racism, white supremacy, when I'm speaking with white people who have agreed to share information about this system to help work against it. If the white people, if they can speak so that a non-white person who does not have a high school diploma can easily grasp what is being said. That way, everybody is getting maximum benefit from the conversation and really getting a great understanding of what's being said so that they can use that information. Do you think that's something that you can do for us today? I think I've done it so far.
I think anybody who listens to what let me ask you a question. Was John Brown white?
I have no idea. I am a non-white person, and I do not have the ability to classify anyone as white or not white. And even if I do, it has no sticking power. So a white person would be the best person to ask about someone's racial classification.
Well, I'm not sure about that. I'm not sure about that. A number of black folk have commented in one way or another that although John Brown looked white, his actions took him out of the ranks of those who upheld white supremacy and therefore took him out of the ranks of the whites. Lerone Bennett talked about John Brown, that John Brown in his heart was a black person, that he felt the injuries and the oppression inflicted on black folk as if it were happening to him, to his immediate family, to his wife, to his sister. Malcolm said similar things. So they were, I don't necessarily think that the whites are the best people to make this decision. Now, I know that the country is not filled with John Browns. There has only been one John Brown and perhaps a few others that have come close. I don't know. I think it's an interesting question.
Well, again, now this is where I would say confusion coming in. To my knowledge, I've never heard a white person say John Brown was not white. Never. Now, I'm not saying that any non-white person, any victim of white supremacy, they can have any view that they like about racism, white supremacy, counter-racism. That is fine. At the end of the day, In my view, the system of white supremacy dictates that the white people who practice racism, white supremacy, are in charge of classifications in terms of who is going to be white and who is not going to be white.
Well, okay. Now, how do you know their class? How do you know how they classify people? What happened to John Brown at the end of his life?
Actually, I would like to get back, because I have a lot of questions I would like to get to, and I would like to ask you some questions about white supremacy to help get clarity. Again, I am not the best person to ask about John Brown being white and or not white. To my knowledge, he's a white person. I suspect he could have been a racist white supremacist. I'm familiar with his actions, but at the end of the day, we are still in a system of white supremacy.
Well, he wasn't. He was hung for opposing that system, for taking up arms, attacking that system with weapons.
That's correct, sir, and the system still exists, does it not?
That's right, but he doesn't. So,
correct,
except in the minds and hearts of the people who cherish his memory. See, I'm trying to ask you, what is white? If it's purely a physical designation of people with fair skin, well, then we have no problem. That's easy. Just draw a line somewhere. I mean, I'm not sure where you want to draw the line, because I know that there are some people who are called white who are, in fact, darker than some people who are called non-white. But assuming that you can make up a list and draw a line somewhere, just do it. That's a simple problem, and then we have no reason for much discussion. But when I talk about white as a social designation, as a social category, or when Thurgood Marshall talked about black as that, I think that what I mean and what Thurgood Marshall meant is a white person who participates in and enjoys the benefits of the white skin in this society.
Would that be... would it be correct, based on what you just said, would it be correct to say that a white person is someone who participates in the system of racism, white supremacy, and enjoys the benefits of that system, enjoys the benefits, privilege of mistreating non-white people?
Yes, I would say that's what is the definition of a white... Well, not even... Yeah, that's what I would say, that's the definition. If by enjoys, you don't necessarily mean gets pleasure from, but takes part in, most of the time not even thinking about it. Yes, I would agree to that. But what about a person who's fair-skinned, who spent all his life fighting against those privileges, and finally, like John Brown, sacrificed his life to it?
Let me ask you, in a system of white supremacy, for a non-white person such as myself, a victim of white supremacy, do you think it would be correct for me to suspect that as long as the system of white supremacy exists, any individual who is classified as white and or accepted as white by other white people, do you think it would be logical for non-white people to suspect that white person, regardless of what they are doing, could be a racist white?
Absolutely, I do. I think you should always keep your suspicions and be alert and so forth. Absolutely, I agree with that.
That is the position I take with regards to John Brown and every other individual that is classified as white, that I think could be white as long as the system exists. Just for clarity's sake, do you fit that definition as a white person who participates in the system of racism, white supremacy?
Well, there's no doubt that in various ways in my life, I am a beneficiary of the privileges of whiteness.
Of white supremacy.
Well, the privileges of whiteness. There would be no whites without white supremacy. The privileges of whiteness, that's what defines white supremacy. There's no doubt in some ways in my life. I am not stopped and thrown up against the wall by the cops because of the way I look. I am not denied jobs. I am not, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. There's no doubt in my mind that some of those things apply to me. There's also no doubt in my mind that I try to resist those behavior patterns as well as I can within the limitations of what is possible to me. Now, I will, rather than argue, that's why I say I will not claim the definition of white for myself. If you want to apply it to me, I won't tell you not to. But you ask me, am I white? And I will never answer that question yes. But if you want to say I'm white, you're welcome to do that. I understand why you would be suspicious of me and any other white, so-called white person, by all means. Hang on to your suspicions. They are justified. But I'm never going to acknowledge being white. or at least I'm too young to do it so far, and I'm only 68 years old.
What could you share with our listeners what you think the constructive value is of a white person, either you or others, because I've heard other white people who also say that they are disassociating themselves with being white and that they do not self-classify as white or they try not to. Can you share with our listeners what you think the constructive value of that is and how that works against racism, white supremacy?
Well, okay. See, I don't claim to have succeeded in withdrawing from the white race. Mm-hmm. You know, I always believe that, you know, even whites who take a step out of it in one circumstance get pulled back into it in another circumstance, if only because of the assumptions of others. You know, I drive down the street, the cop doesn't stop me. I mean, I have nothing to do with that, but that's what happens. So I don't claim to have pulled out, and I think it's devilishly difficult for any individual to pull out because, as I say, even if he takes a step out of whiteness in one context, he'll be pulled back in into another. Unless, like John Brown, he takes a step out that is so dramatic that he gets executed for it. And then he's not either white or black. He's beyond those definitions. He's both dead and eternal. The advantage, however, for people doing that, I think, or attempting to do that, as I say, I want to stress that, is that people have to come to understand that the white race is not a natural social formation. Not a natural biological formation. It is a social formation. That is, it's a club. It's a club that whose membership consists of all those who are assigned to it. And like any club, I mean, it can be broken up. I think it would be a good idea to break it up. I think it would be a good idea to abolish the white race as a social category. Now, I don't care about getting rid of people with fair skin. You know, I like all human colors. That's one of the things that make this planet interesting, is that no two people look exactly alike. But I think it would be a good idea to break up that club. And I think part of that, key to doing that, is the recognition that, in fact, it is a club, that people are born into it, assigned to it, brought up according to its rules, extended its benefits, and also extracted its costs, without, for the most part, ever thinking about it. For the most part, they don't think about, well, I'm white, what else? And then they move on to the next problem. And by, I think, talking about the possibility of breaking up the club, or in extremely rare and exceptional circumstances, pulling out of it, I think that's a way of bringing to people the understanding that it is a club. It's a club that's upheld by rules and by the society and by police and social workers and all the other agents and so forth. So that's what I think the benefit of it is.
And again, this is why I said I think I have seen a constructive benefit from requesting that when people speak about racism, white supremacy, they try to do so that even a person who does not have a high school diploma can grasp what's being said.
Do you think anything I said is beyond the reach of anybody with a high school diploma, without a high school diploma?
Well,
you don't think people can understand a club with membership and benefits and privileges?
What I was going to say is that I have a high school diploma, and I'm not sure that I got what the constructive benefit is of you classifying or not classifying yourself as a white person.
I'll say it again in one sentence, because it helps break up the club.
How does it do that?
By raising for others the possibility that this is not simply a natural formation like being a human being, which has to do with biology, but is the result of history and social rules and so forth. And I want people to come to understand that the history and social rules were made by human beings and therefore can be unmade. When I teach my students, I tell them that apart from the human race, every we is the product of history. We, the people of the United States, we, the white people, we, the members of professional associations, every we is a product of history. And I always tell my students, I don't mind them talking about we and they, but I want them to understand that every we that they think that they're a part of, except the human family as a whole, is the result of history, and I want them to make conscious decisions about which we they want to be part of. And I'm trying to bring that consciousness to light. Now, I don't know how to make it any clearer than that.
I'm sure some of it is my suspicion, and some of it is probably my victimization. But I know I have encountered white people who have said the same thing, that they, being white is not a biological fact. In fact, that there's no biological evidence to support race at all.
Mm-hmm.
It's something that's
right.
made up. They said pretty much what you said,
mm-hmm.
you know, not in different words. However, these white people
still act white.
Yes. No, they have still functioned like
that's
white
supremacists. Yeah. Oh, I agree with you that I'm not suggesting that you drop your suspicions. I'm not suggesting that you embrace me, brother. Thank you for saying this. I'm not suggesting that at all. When I talk about this in this way, it's primarily aimed at the white folks who I'm trying to get them to break apart that club that they are members of without even thinking about it, for the most part. You see, I'm aiming it at them. I'm not trying to tell you to love me or trust me or anything like that. You have very good reasons. We've never met. You have very good reasons. You don't know anything about my life, but you know plenty about the life of lots and lots of white folks in this country, including plenty of them who've said they're friends of the black folk. So I'm not suggesting you trust me merely because I say I am. I am asking you, however, to understand why it is that I say that, because I'm trying to explode this white race and blow it apart. And I would appreciate any sympathy that you might give me, but that's my job, whether you go along or not.
That is very helpful, what you just said about you primarily speaking to white people to try to undo the white club, to get them to understand. That is very helpful, and I guess that would help me also as hosting this show. My show is designed primarily for non-white people, even though a lot of white people listen to this show. It would be helpful if you could keep that in mind, that this is designed for non-white people. So if you could, I don't know if you can alter what you say or just keep that conscious.
Oh, well, thank you.
This is for non-white folks.
Right. I make it a point never to try and make strategy or tell black folk how to wage their struggle for freedom. I think that if they're interested in what I'm doing, I'm glad to tell them. And if they ask my opinion, I'm glad to offer it. But as a general rule, I think black folk have to make these decisions for themselves. And so I don't. But on the other hand, you asked me here, knowing that I was not a person of color, because you were interested in things that I have to say, in part, I think, because your audience is interested. Well, who's this curious guy whose society thinks is white, but he doesn't particularly want to claim that label? He's worth thinking about. And that's all I'm trying to do, is explain to you where I'm coming from, explain to you and your audience. But I'm certainly not asking you to put down your guns, so to speak, or trust me or any of that sort of thing.
I respect that.
All right.
I wanted to ask, because you said that the system of white supremacy, the white club, is held together by rules. Could you help our non-white listeners, who, including myself, who don't really understand that, can you share with us how a white person learns to function as a white supremacist?
Oh, boy, that's so complicated. They start learning it when they're real early. There are certain kinds of assumptions that they learn almost, you know, from, well, not quite from the cradle, but certainly from the early years, of places you're not, neighborhoods you're not supposed to go, people you're not supposed to go out with, music maybe you're not supposed to listen to, although that's been shaken up some lately because everybody's listening to black music. And they learn that, you know, if some injury is done or something bad happens to a black person, you're not supposed to think that that's your fault, or I'm not supposed to think that that's my problem. They learn to take for granted the advantages. It's like I was trying to explain what it means to be white to my son, who at the time was about 8 years old. And I said, well, to be white, John Henry, is to go to the birthday party always expecting you're going to get the biggest piece of cake. All right? Now, if you go to the birthday party and you take it for granted, of course I'm going to be in front of the line, me and the others who look like me, of course, and so on. Now, I think that if people become aware and say, wait a minute, why am I getting the biggest piece of cake? Why isn't this little kid next to me, who, so far as I can see, is same age as me and got here at the same time? Why is he getting a smaller piece of cake? And to start asking those questions, you see, is to begin to question the operation of the white club. And by itself, a few questions, of course, don't tear the club down. But they do begin to question it. And how people learn that, well, it's, you know, it's complicated. All of society is set up to teach them. And for the most part, it doesn't even require conscious, deliberate teaching and thought. The lessons just sort of get learned because that's the atmosphere. If I go into the wrong neighborhood, well, why are you going there at night? Don't you know you're supposed to be afraid? Or if I go out socially with the wrong color of person, they say, well, why are you doing that? Or if I hang around on the job with the wrong group of people, well, are you jeopardizing your chances of promotion? And all these lessons in school. If I go into school and I see that the gifted classes are all made up of white kids and the special ed classes are all made up of the black kids, and every little black boy that comes into the public school is dosed with Ritalin and assigned to a special ed class, well, after a while, even if I don't think about it, I begin to say, well, those people must be dumb, you see. And the lessons get transmitted very subtly over years and years of time. And I think after a while, people come to take it for granted. And most of the time, really don't even think about it. You know, they think about it maybe when they're young or a little bit. But most of the time, that's just the way it is around us. We grow up that way. Let me ask you, let me give you a parallel.
Mm.
Most people in this society go out and work for a wage, right?
Mm.
Now, there have been times in the past when nobody worked for wages. There have been times in the past when people thought it was slavery, working for somebody else for money. And there may come a time in the future when people will look back on us in the year 2009 and say, can you imagine those poor people back then actually sold their life's energy and intelligence and life's blood for money? God, they were like slaves. But we don't think of it that way. We all work for wages. It's the most natural thing around us. You see? And so all of us grow up thinking about, where can I find a good job? Right? Now, it seems to me it's parallel. It's not that anybody has to beat into us that the wage system is the best system that's ever been engineered and designed. Of course, there are some people who say that. But rather, we grow up, and it's all around us, and it's the most natural thing. And therefore, it hardly can ever even occur to any of us that there might be another way of living, that human beings might organize their collective labor without the use of wages. And if once in a while somebody suggests that, wait a minute, there might be another way of dividing up human labor and assigning human work and relating to each other aside from wages, people will say, oh, you're crazy, or you're a communist, or you got to go to jail, or whatever. It seems to me it's very similar to whiteness. It's not that anybody has to be beat over the head to force them to be white. It's that they just grow up that way all around them. Now, I think that there have been times, the 1960s is the last time I remember, when the black movement was so strong and so powerful that it was challenging the privileges of whiteness on the job and in the schools and, you know, pretty much throughout the society. And I think it began to force a lot of others, a lot of so-called white people, to think about, wait a minute, did I earn these privileges? Do I have privileges, and did I earn them? I think the black movement has historically, I think the same thing, of course, was true under slavery and abolition. The black movement has been a challenge to so-called white folks to start to think about, wait a minute, who am I? What is my relation to my fellow human beings? What part do I play in this system, you see? But for most of the time, they just go along following the program, the way most human beings have done since the beginning of history. Follow the world around you.
I wanted to see if this would be an accurate summary. Would it be correct to say that in a system, in the system of white supremacy, white people are conditioned by every aspect of society to see non-white people as people rather should be mistreated and nothing should be done about it, or people that they should directly be mistreating because they are not white. Would that be correct?
I'd say it's a little bit of an overstatement. See, I think that there's a small number of white people, so maybe 5-10%, something like that, who are really active, conscious, deliberate agents of racial oppression. I think there are a small number of so-called white people who are really against it and would really like to stop it. But then I think probably someplace around 80 or 90% of the white folks don't even think about it. It's not like they get up in the morning and start to think, how can I go out today and mistreat black folk? They got their own problems. They got their lousy jobs and their troubled marriages and their children that they can't relate to and all the rest of the things that they got going on. And they just don't get out there and think about other people. And so they let, and it's not my business, they let the world go on around them and say, well, it's probably too bad. Like, you know, for instance, years ago, what happened to Rodney King? You know, well, I think that most white folks thought, Jesus, that was pretty bad. That was too bad. That shouldn't happen. But then after a couple of days, they went back to their own private problems. You know, why should they be concerned? I got my troubles, too. And see, I think that most white folks in this country do not consider themselves, first of all, they don't think about it. Then if they do think about it and they do believe that black people have historically got a raw deal, well, they think, oh, that's in the past and it's been mostly fixed. Then the third thing is if they agree that they're still getting a raw deal, they say, well, it's not my problem. What can I do about it? And Wendell Phillips, the great abolitionist from Boston, used to stand up in front of a crowd of Bostonians, and he would say to them, fellow subjects of Virginia. And what he was trying to see, because the people in Massachusetts, they were all anti-slavery. 95% of them were anti-slavery. But they thought they had nothing to do with it. It was somebody else's problem. And Wendell Phillips used to get up there and push their noses in their own complicity. He would say, look, it was your guns that paid for the army that put down Nat Turner. It was your guns that paid for the army that put down John Brown. It is your guns that keep the police force going, that keeps the slaves in bondage. And that's the point he was always trying to make, that it's not somebody else's doing. It's not happening outside. It's happening right there, except that you are blinded to it because, one, it's not easy to see, and second of all, it's more comfortable not to see it. Because if you start raising these questions, then you may find yourself banished or expelled from the white club and lose the benefits, you see. And so, as I said, I think it's an overstatement to say that all white people are dedicated to the oppression of black people.
I want to be clear, because that was not what I said.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry then if I misheard you.
Yeah, what I said was that white, and it seems what you just said seems pretty close to exactly what I said. What I said was that in the system of white supremacy, white people are conditioned by everything in society to see non-white people as people who are mistreated and that they shouldn't care about the fact that these people are mistreated, and or, hey, you should mistreat these people and enjoy doing so. And
well,
it seems like what you just said, a large chunk of people see non-whites, Rodney King or whoever else, non-white, mistreated, and they don't really feel like that's their problem. They don't really have any concern for them being mistreated.
I think you're right about that, or not enough concern to make them do anything serious about it. Yeah, I think you're right about that. I just was taking issue with your idea that most white people think that it's right that those people should, other people should be mistreated. I don't think they do.
I didn't say most. I did not.
Or a large. Well, okay. I don't know how many. But let me give you an analogy. See, I think the strength of a society, of an oppressive society, is the ability to confine the active oppression, the specific, to a small number of deliberate conscious agents and leave most people out of it, or at least let them think that they're out of it. Most white people in this country are not aware that they play any part in the oppression of non-whites. The system is set up so that they don't have to directly take part. All they have to do is take the college entrance boards, and you... Hello, are you still there?
Yes,
and
sir.
You,
hold on.
All right.
Hold on one second, because at this point I want to remind you These are non-white people.
Mm-hmm.
I have concluded, and many of the white people who've come on my broadcast, Tim Wise and many others, have felt it would be constructive if non-white people suspected that that white person is racist and that they are consciously racist. And I wholeheartedly agree with that. I do not see enough suspicion amongst non-white people. It has been my conclusion. I don't think it's constructive for non-white people to think that most white people are gleefully ignorant about this system.
Okay, I wouldn't tell you what to think, as I said before, but I am telling you what I think. And if you mind, I'd like to say that. And you can decide whether it's of use to you or not.
Right. The only problem is that I have a lot of questions that I would like to get to, and it would be helpful if I could get more concise answers.
All right. Well, I'm sorry. If you don't like what I'm saying, you know, you can hang up, but I've got to say what I've got to say.
If
you think I'm talking too many words, you tell me which words you'd like me to cut out. Now, I was trying to tell you another story. I was trying to give you some examples.
That's the thing. That's the thing, is that the analogies, I would really like to hear what you have to say, but I would like to get specific answers because I have questions.
Well, I thought I am giving you specific answers, and you may not agree with them, which is your privilege, and I respect that. But I've got to make my argument. I've got to, let me give you an example.
Sir.
Yes.
It would be very helpful if I could ask my questions to get you to give me answers. That would be very helpful. I heard your answer to the previous question. I understood what you said. I have other questions that I would like to ask.
That's very good, but I'm going to answer the questions until I'm finished and I'm satisfied I've said what I have to say. Now, if you think that you go ahead and answer. Now, I had something else I was trying to make a point to you. Now, if you don't want to hear my point, okay, I'll drop it.
That would be helpful. It would.
What, did I drop my point? Well, let me just try and make this point to you.
Sir, I feel...
You know, we can hang up anytime you like.
I understand that, sir.
I am not Tim Wise. I am not here, you know, to ingratiate myself with you. I am here to tell you what I think.
I understand that, sir. It would be helpful if I could ask my questions. If you do not want to assist me in allowing me to ask as many questions as I can in the limited amount of time that we have for this program, you can certainly do that. It would be helpful for me if I could get more concise answers. And if I could move forward, because
I think it would be helpful to me if I'd be able, and you decide whether it's helpful to you. I have to say what I have to say, and if you think my answers are too long, then I'm sorry. I'm not finished with what I have to say.
Do you think you could wrap up what you have to say?
No, I'm going to tell you one or two more stories, and if that's not satisfactory to you.
That is not satisfactory, because
I'm not going to hear 20 questions in which I give one-sentence answers to. If you don't like my answers, you think they're too complicated, okay, find somebody else to interview, or stop asking me, ask me another set of questions in another interview. I'm not going to tell you how to run your show, but don't tell me how to frame my answers, please.
I'm not telling you how to frame your answers if you do not feel this is constructive. Well, how about this? This is a question I would like to ask. If you do not wish to answer it, that's fine.
I'm sure I'll ask. Go ahead. What's your question? I may not be finished answering the last one, though.
My question is, could you please share with us specific examples of how you have functioned as a racist white supremacist in the system of white supremacy?
I have not functioned as a racist white supremacist. I have never been a racist white supremacist.
Okay.
I have certainly passively benefited from the privileges of whiteness, and I gave you examples. Apparently you want me to repeat them. I told you that the cops don't bust me. I don't lose jobs because of color. I have access to clubs. I've told you all that. Mm-hmm. But I haven't functioned as a racist white supremacist. Now, I would like to finish explaining to you what I was doing before. And anybody who says I have is slandering me. It's not true.
No one has. I'm just curious.
Well, you asked, how have I functioned? And I told you I have not.
You answered the question.
Thank you. Now, I would like to give you an example.
Hold on a second. Are you with the same question?
I'm going to try and give you some examples so that it will make clear the distinction which you seem to have. I would like to explain further. The point I am making to you is that there are some people in the society who are specifically charged professionally, it's their job, like concentration camp guards, to enforce on oppression. Most people in the society go along with it, for the most part, in general, with some exceptions, because they don't think about it. Now, if you look at another country in the world where there is, I think, a very good parallel to the United States, Israel. Israel is a country where tremendous numbers of people called Jews carry weapons, take part in the army, and deliberately and consciously are all implicated in the oppression of the Palestinians. Much more so than in the United States, where a relatively small number of people are directly implicated in that. In the American West, ordinary white Americans carry guns to kill Indians. But today it doesn't happen that way. It's done through the Bureau of Indian Affairs and the public institutions and so forth and so on. So most white Americans have no idea of the misery on the reservations, or if they have an idea, they think it's not their fault. Now, that's the distinction I'm trying to make for you. And it seems to me that the United States has become a society in which a relatively small number of specialists and activists are directly involved in enforcing white supremacy, and the rest of the white folks, for the most part, just go along. Now, part of what I am trying to do is what Wendell Phillips tried to do in Massachusetts in 1844, is to wake up the whites to the fact that they are complicit, that they are involved, not necessarily by joining a lynch mob or a Klan or anything else, but by taking part in the structures of privilege in the society and benefiting from them. Now, does that help make my point clear?
I understand.
Did I waste your time in saying that?
Sir, I understand what you're saying. I again want to point out, you are accepted as white by other white people. I am a victim of white supremacy. I feel like if you say that you're working against the system of racism, white supremacy, no white person should be upset, hostile with a non-white person for any reason. They should be Mr. Rogers, as cordial as possible in dealing with a non-white person. I don't think that's asking too much.
Oh, I think that's asking too much.
Well,
look, I mean, I think I'm certainly not. I mean, if you're not willing to give me a chance to express my point of view, then I think that there's not much point in this conversation. I mean, if you think that your color by itself makes you right and makes me wrong, we're not going to agree on that. Now, I'm not hostile to you about that.
I have never asserted whether you're correct or I'm incorrect.
All right. Well, all I'm trying to do is make my point, and apparently you don't like to hear what I have to say. That's okay. It's your privilege to decide whether what I have to say is valuable.
The point I would like to emphasize, sir, is that what I said at the beginning of the program, I think it is helpful in conversations on racism, white supremacy, for everyone to speak as though they're talking to someone who does not have a high school diploma. And I have found that is most effective in making answers concise and not having lots of analogies and extra stories to try to be as direct and simple as possible.
Listen, if you think I'm not doing a good job, then fire me. I didn't ask to be on your show. You read my material. You know my book. You know what I have to say. And you invited me. If you don't want me, then disinvite me.
The next question that I have, sir, is... you said you have not functioned as a racist white supremacist. Are you saying you have never mistreated someone because they are not white?
Well, I one time remember I used the N-word and my father gave me a whack across the side of the head so severe that I never forgot it. He said, I never want to hear you say that again. I remember one time when a black fellow and I were riding in a car together with a white woman, and she was driving, and on the way out someplace we were going, I sat in the front seat. And on the way back, I started to turn around and sit in the front seat, and she said, no, it's his turn to sit in the front seat. And I realized that she was right and that I had made an assumption that somehow or other I was supposed to be there. And I felt very ashamed of myself for that and tried to think about that. I think there are probably other times when I have said dumb things. But no, I have never participated in a lynch mob. I have never tried to deny a job to a person who was black and so forth. I'm sure that from time to time, I have been quiet in the face of other white folks doing bad things, have been blind and been unable to see what was happening. It may be that my memory is mercifully kind to me and there's things I don't remember, but no, I cannot say that I can recall ever going out and injuring a black person because of his color. I was not raised to do that.
Could you share with us, if you can recall, could you share with us incidents where you observed another white person, a suspected racist, mistreating someone where they were not white, and you didn't do anything about that?
Yeah, there have been times when I kept quiet. People would say things, and I would keep quiet. Later on, I was ashamed of myself.
Can you think of, like, some specific examples?
Well, yeah. I mean, the jokes that people tell or the remarks or the assumptions that, you know, where I'm supposed to be, and I didn't challenge it. I didn't, you know. Sure, there have been times. I remember in, you know, I was working in a steel mill. I mean, sometimes I did the right thing and sometimes I didn't. You know, I don't claim to be Superman. But to the extent that I have been aware of my actions, I have tried to do the right thing. I remember one time I was working in a steel mill and we had two showers. And I didn't notice. One was the white shower, one was the black shower. And it wasn't the rule, it wasn't the law. But I wasn't aware of it. So I was showering, and one of the white guys said to me, "Oh, you ought to come into the other shower and shower." So I did. I didn't even think about it. The water's hotter, or some, you know, nonsense like that. So I went in and showered there, and then I looked around me and I realized that was the white shower. So I said, "No, I'm not going to do that." I went back and showered in the black shower. Now, that was not a big deal, you know. I don't suggest that anybody gain freedom because of where I chose to wash my body, you know, after a day in a steel mill. But I went along with it for a little bit, and then I thought about it, and then I didn't.
Hmm. Are there, because you talked about earlier, like the example you gave about the showers, you said that if you start to ask questions about, if you're a white person, and you start to ask questions about racism, white supremacy, you can be banished from the club. Could you give us specific examples of how discipline is enforced in the system of white supremacy in terms of making sure that white people follow the rules and don't break the racist code?
Well, the outstanding example is John Brown, who was hung for breaking the racist code. I can think of one or two examples from my life. I remember I was working in a factory, and I was a toolmaker, skilled trade in a farm equipment plant. And I looked around, I realized that all the toolmakers, the skilled tradesmen, were white. The assembly line workers and the laborers were black. So I began asking why that was the case. And they said, well, there's an apprenticeship exam, and the black folks don't do well in the apprenticeship exam. So I thought about this a while, and then I stood up at a union meeting, and I said, well, I don't think that this apprenticeship exam ought to be used to keep black folk out. It seems to me that they ought to have a different kind of exam. They ought to drive around in the streets, and whenever they saw some kid keeping an old beater of an automobile running, they ought to realize that the kid was mechanically inclined, and they should extend him an apprenticeship. And I said, and therefore, that if we did that, then we'd have some black folks in the gang. Well, I thought it was innocent enough. I don't know if I'd have the kind of courage now to do what I did then. But I thought what I said was innocent enough and nice enough. When I came back to work on Monday, that was a union meeting on Saturday or Sunday morning, I forget. I came to work on Monday. There were swastikas on my toolbox. There were filthy things written about me on the walls in the bathroom. People refused to speak to me. If I asked somebody to help me lift a piece, he'd turn around and say no and wouldn't help me. I mean, that was enforcing. I was sent off to isolation. I was banished. Now, I must say that the black workers in that plant responded to that little thing I did, which I didn't risk my life or even really risk my job. All I did was risk good relations with my coworkers. The black workers responded to me with a wonderful outpouring of sympathy and solidarity. They were just splendid, probably more than I deserved. But they were so generous and so good to me. I remember there was one fella, this was back in the early 70s, you know, and he had this big, giant natural, and he looked in the way that scared the hell out of the white folks, although he was the sweetest guy in the world. And he used to come all the way over from the paint shop every day and walk into my plant, shoulders thrown back, swaggering, and walk up to my machine and, "How you doing?" and sit and chat with me for a minute or two. And I one time asked him, why do you do that? And he says, "I just want to let these people here over here know that you're not by yourself." Now, in fact, I have found I am no hero. I don't have a long list of great examples. I'm not John Brown. I'm just an ordinary person who tries to do the right thing sometimes when he can, and sometimes manages to do it and sometimes doesn't. But on those times when I have done the right thing, I have felt the immediate, sympathetic, warm appreciation and response of the black people, and it has been one of the things that has made my life worth living. Now, let me tell you another story. When I was about 18 years old, 17 maybe, my first year out of high school, I was walking in downtown Philadelphia. It was just a summer evening. I saw a cop had a black man up against the wall, was questioning him. The cop was white. The cop was white. And the man was black up against the wall, was questioning him. And I was just 17 years old. And I, you know, and when the cop finished questioning the guy, he hauled off and slugged the guy in the gut. So I walked over there. I said, "What are you doing?" I was all excited. You know, I was only, "What are you doing? You're not supposed to do that. What are you doing?" Well, the next thing I knew, the cop had arrested me and thrown me in the slammer, and I spent the night in jail. Well, all right, no big deal. You know, didn't kill me. I went to court the next morning and tried to tell my story of what I saw had happened. And, of course, the judge interrupted me and said, "No, this officer was trying to do his job, and you interfered, and $25 fine, and out you go," and so forth and so on. Well, again, $25 didn't kill me. You know, I had the $25. But an old black lady came by to me as I was walking out, and she came over to me, and she said, "God bless you." Well, ever since that, I have felt blessed. And as I say, if the time ever comes when I have to stand before the throne of the Lord and justify the air that I breathed on this earth, I will cite that example and say, "Well, that was the good thing that I did in my life that I'm proud of, and it was immediately appreciated by black folk."
Wow. Do you know what happened to the black guy?
Yeah, he was... I think the charges against him were dismissed. It was nothing. It turned out the cop said he propositioned some white woman around the corner. Well, it was nonsense, you know. I mean, I think the charges against him were dropped. As I recall, you know, it's over 50 years ago, so it's hard to remember. But as I recall, when I tried to find out what happened to him to see if I could reach him and connect with him, I think that's what I found out. He was not charged at the same time as me, so I can't be sure of that.
Okay. Context of white supremacy, I guess, Noel Ignatiev. I have concluded why I'm doing this program. Non-white people, victims of white supremacy, are not informed, certainly not informed enough, about the system of white supremacy, what it is, and how it works. Do you think that is true?
No, I do not. Well, that, in a sense, that's a little too quick of an answer. In a sense that nobody is quite as informed about anything as they should be. But on the other hand, I think that the black folk that I have known over the years, particularly the older ones of my age and so on, have a tremendous, terrific, very sophisticated and developed understanding of how the system of white supremacy works, and it's the white people who don't understand it. Now, I understand there are some exceptions, and there are some stupid black folk out there who don't understand, you know, that... You know, as Rap Brown said, don't understand a man's got his foot up their butt until they smell shoe polish on their breath. But by and large, I feel that black people have had a far better understanding of the system of white supremacy than white Americans have had. Although, of course, everybody could always learn more.
How do the, you said black people specifically, so how do the black people that you know, how do they demonstrate that they are informed about white supremacy?
Well, for one thing, by being very suspicious of all whites, including the whites who profess to be their friends. I think that's a very... Including me. That's a very wise attitude.
Okay.
I don't take that. Sometimes it hurts. But on the other hand, I don't take it personal. I understand why people feel that way. I think that's a very wise attitude. No black man was ever lynched in this country because he was too suspicious of white folks. So that's one thing. Another thing is they see through all the political institutions. They know how the political parties and the business world and the labor unions and the schools and the admissions programs and liberals and all the rest of this stuff. They have a very sophisticated understanding, I think, of how these institutions operate to keep them down. Now, when I say they, I mean black folk who grew up in the days of before civil rights, in the days of the old outright, you know, flat-out open racial separation. I have found, and this you would know better than I, and so I really don't want to go into this at any length, but I have found out that among young black folk, some of that, a great deal of that knowledge has been lost.
Hmm.
However, among old black folk, say 55 or 60 on up, I think they impress me as having a tremendous amount of understanding.
Right. Let me make sure I'm understanding you correctly here. You're saying that the black people that you know who are 55 and up, who experienced, I guess, more blatant forms of racism, white supremacy, they have a very sophisticated understanding of white supremacy that is demonstrated in being suspicious of all white people, including you, and they see...
And of all institutions.
I'm sorry.
And of all institutions.
And all institutions.
And all political saviors, yes.
Okay.
Now, I would say in general. Now, obviously, that does not apply to everyone,
mm-hmm.
and I don't wish to exaggerate it. But, yes, in general, I have been tremendously impressed with the wisdom of black Americans over the years. With the wisdom of black Americans over the years.
Okay.
Their humor, their sense of long-term, their ability to understand how things are going on and to how to figure out how to respond to it. I remember years ago being on a subway and noticing that any time something happened on a subway that had maybe any racial import, some white drunk standing too close to a black woman or anything at all, immediately I watched and all the black people on the subway would check each other out with their eyes to get ready to do something if necessary. I thought that was tremendous wisdom and experience, and I have tried to learn from that.
Hmm. And I also wanted to point out, because I think this is very important, you said, even though you're not as knowledgeable, that amongst the younger black people, you think some of that understanding of white supremacy has been lost because they have not experienced the more blatant forms of racism, white
people. Well, also because they've grown up in a world where they think they see black faces in positions of prominence where there didn't used to be any, why they even have a president who is black.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that for some people believe that, you know, that all that is from the past. They don't want to hear those old stories and so forth. But, you know, you would know that more than I, so I don't want to go into that too much.
Do you think that as non-white people, as they become more informed about racism, white supremacy, or even amongst the black people that you know, that you say are lies about white supremacy, do you think they demonstrate that awareness in not having or minimizing the amount of conflict they have with other non-white people?
I'm not sure I think about that. What do you mean by that?
Do you think, let's see if I can simplify it. Do you think in a system of white supremacy, it would be intelligent for the non-white people to make every effort to reduce the amount of conflict that they have with other non-white people under a system of white supremacy?
Well, again, you're asking me to express an opinion on what black folks should do, and so I really don't want to do that, right? Because
right.
That's, after all, that's offering advice, and I'm not in a position to do that. What I want to do, however, and this I can say as, I think, an observer and a historian, and I could say this neither black nor white, is that some things have changed since the old days when the meanest, crudest, most degraded white man was elevated above any black person. When, to put it in metaphorical terms, when Huckleberry Finn's dad, the town drunk, could push W.E.B. Du Bois off the sidewalk. That every so-called Negro, no matter how prosperous, educated, well-behaved, and well-dressed, could be insulted, degraded, and humiliated by some mean, low-down white person and get away with it and nothing happened. Now, I think some things have changed in that. I think there is now a sector of black America which has been assimilated, integrated, absorbed into the ruling circles of American society. Not to say that they are never subject to insults or stupidities from the white stupidos, but that by and large, they, in the foundations and in certain political spheres and in some places in the colleges, that these people have, to a considerable extent, escaped the old kind of oppression and have been made into full partners, no longer plantation politics, no longer the HNIC, no longer the one who bosses over the other black folk, but are participants in the shaping of the global system of white supremacy that you describe. And I'm sure you can think of some names like that. Now, at the same time that has happened, the situation of the poor black folk at the bottom has gotten worse and more miserable than it ever was before, or at least than it ever has been for 100 years. You see? And it's, I think it's very interesting that some black folk are now pretty much full partners and participants in the maintenance of a system of oppression over others, including the poor black folks and even some white folks who are down at the bottom of the pile. Now, I remember when September 11th happened, you know, and I won't tell you the whole story, but, you know, I frankly was not terribly surprised by that. I figured the United States carries out these crimes against the darker peoples of the earth all over the world. It should not be a surprise when things come back. But, and so, you know, I was, of course, I'm not an unfeeling person, and I did not celebrate, you know, the blowing up of the World Trade Center or the killing of all those people. But on the other hand, you know, it was not a big surprise to me. I didn't spend my weeks weeping over it. But a week later, I was riding on a bus in my neighborhood, and I looked out the bus window, and I saw four young black men, maybe 19, 20, 21 years old, beating a fifth one with a baseball bat.
Say that again, please.
I saw four or five young black men out the window of my bus beating a fifth one on the ground with a baseball bat.
Another black person.
Yes, yes, yes. And I was shocked. I was stunned. I didn't know what to do. It happened so quickly, and the bus was moving. I didn't know, get off the bus. But, of course, I didn't want him to turn on me with a baseball bat. I just didn't know what to do. I was shocked to hell. And I was thinking about it. I thought about it. I don't know what happened. I started to tell people on the other people on the bus, let's get off the bus. Let's save this youngster, you know. I didn't know what to do, and the result is I didn't do anything. I don't know if there was anything I could have done. But I thought about it a lot later on. And I said to myself that that is the real horror of life in America. Here are these five beautiful young black men, the flower of our country. And these are people who are killing each other, fighting over some drug or some turf or some girl or whatever it was. But I knew that they had no business doing that to each other. And to me, that captured the horror of life in America today, far more than the World Trade Center did. And when I think about that, I realize that now the chief of police and the superintendent of prisons and the various judges and the president of the United States and all the other people are many of the people who are administering that system of horror that is inflicting such pain on these young people and many others like them. Some of those, most of those people are still white, I know that, but some of them are black. And it seems to me that that's changed, so that what you have now is not the old-fashioned, generalized oppression of black by white. What you have now is the oppression of many poor blacks and some poor whites of a system by a system whose dominant expression, whose implementers are made up of many whites and some blacks. And it seems to me that that has changed somewhat.
Again, wanted to point out system of white supremacy. I have concluded, and I could be incorrect, all of the non-white people are victims to and subject to the white people who practice white supremacy. Mm-hmm. But I wanted to get back to the question because I know you said you did not want to offer advice to black people. You didn't feel that was your place. With the story that you just pointed out about the young black people that you saw on the bus that were beating this other black person with a baseball bat, I guess I'm that is a
they were on the street. They weren't on the bus. I was on the bus, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay,
yes, sir.
Go ahead.
I wanted to illustrate I feel the story that you just shared illustrates my view that if non-white people, particularly younger ones, were informed about racism, white supremacy, or really any non-white people, they would work to minimize those sorts of incidents. You would not see black people beating other black people with a baseball bat. You would not see non-white people generating conflict with other non-white people in a system of white supremacy. I think that that is logical, that if there's going to be conflict in a system of white supremacy, it should be either between a white person and another group of white people, a la John Brown, or it should be between white people and non-white people. I think that's logical. Do you have a view on that? Or?
Well, I would say only this. I mean, of course, I respect your view, but I would say only this, that people are as they do to the extent that there are black folk or people with dark skins who are full participants, active, engaged, administrators, implementers, supervisors of oppressive systems, then I would say that those people have to be opposed, whatever color they are. If the white social worker insults black people, then she has to be fought when they go down. And if there's a black social worker that treats her black clients with contempt and disdain, well, I will leave it to you to decide how to deal with her.
Oh, I would say it's incorrect both ways. I mean, what you observed with those black males beating that other black person, I mean, that's disgraceful. That is absolutely disgraceful.
Very sad.
Totally incorrect and should not happen to anyone. Shouldn't have to a white person, shouldn't have to anyone.
Right.
What I'm saying is if there's going to be conflict, I would make every effort to make sure that that happens between a non-white person and a white person, or ideally between a white person and another white person.
Well, the latter is, of course, what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to stoke up that conflict among the whites.
And
that's what I'm trying to do. And so far as you're trying to organize the black folk to fight against white supremacy, the only question I would put to you is what is your attitude toward the black folk who are part of the system of implementing white supremacy? That's something for you to think about. I'm not going to tell you, but I guess you better think about it.
My answer would be that they are victims of white supremacy just like me. I wanted to ask...
That's an interesting point of view.
In the system of white supremacy, do you believe that the white supremacists are most responsible for anything that happens on this planet amongst people? Do you think that's correct?
That's an interesting question. What I think is most responsible for happening... Let me go back to those five youngsters.
Mm.
All right? I think that they are at the tail end of a miserablest system on the whole planet that has condemned a whole lot of the human race to marginality and unproductivity, that it has robbed them of a future, it has taken from them hope, it has denied them the possibility of finding a decent job and creating for themselves even a modest, decent life that most Americans have been taught to want. And the result of it is their rage at each other is a product of their victimization. Now, I think in general that's probably true all around the world, in Iran and Afghanistan and Somalia and Brazil and every place else. So, yes, I do think that the poor and the downtrodden, the majority of whom on the face of the earth are dark peoples, are the victims. On the other hand, I would love it to see them get themselves together and perhaps find some friendly fair skins to help them and join them and bring the system down.
Me too. Me too. I wanted to ask just specifically, there we go, about white people who allege to be anti-racist. I myself, I do not think that that term is accurate as long as the system of white supremacy exists. And my reason is that I do not believe any white person in the known universe could prove that they are so-called anti-racist. As long as the system of white supremacy exists, they would be a suspected racist at best. They could say that they're trying to do anti-racist work, they want to do anti-racist work, but as long as the system exists, no one can say they have done anti-racist work. Do you feel that that is a logical, correct stance to take?
Yes, I do, but let me amend it in this way, if I may. See, racism is not a term that I use. I use the term white supremacy or whiteness. And the reason I don't use the term racism, or I try not to use it, although I occasionally slide into it, is because racism means different things to black folk and white folk. To black folk, it means that they're on the bottom and they're victims. To white folk, to be a racist means to have maintained conscious, deliberate, prejudiced ideas. And see, as I said before, I don't think that the main problem in the society is that most white folk walk around with prejudiced ideas trying to be mean to black folk. The main problem in this society is that there is a system of white supremacy operating, and most white folks go along with it quietly for the most part. Therefore, rather than talk to them about them being racists, which they will respond by saying, wait a minute, I'm not prejudiced, I would rather talk to them about whiteness or white supremacy. How do we explain that these good jobs are held almost entirely by white folks? How do we explain that the number of black students in this school, Goods College right in the middle of the city, there are hardly any black students there? Now, that is not primarily because the admissions department or the employment agencies are prejudiced. It happens primarily because there's a system. The schools in the black neighborhoods are bad. The teachers don't have much respect for kids. The parents don't have good jobs, et cetera, et cetera. It's a self-reinforcing circular system. So that's one reason that I prefer to shift the discussion not from away from the term racism to the term whiteness. And as somebody said to me years ago, there ought to be a term for all those white people who participate without doing very much thinking in a system of racial oppression. And I said, there is a term for them. The term is white. Does that seem logical to you? See, what I find when I talk, excuse me, before, what I find when I talk to white people and accuse them of being racist, they respond defensively. I'm not racist. I'm not prejudiced. Well, all right. See, I don't want to argue because I don't know what's in their hearts. What I know, however, is a society based on racial oppression. That I know. And so I can say, okay, if you are not prejudiced, then look around you and explain to me how the world is as it is. And if you don't do anything about it, then what is your role in either reproducing that or undermining it? And that's why I'd rather talk about whiteness or white supremacy or racial oppression and not use the term racism. You may have noticed in my book on the Irish, it's a whole book about racial oppression, and I didn't use the word racism. I didn't need to. I was able to make my point without it.
I also try to work to use the term white supremacy as often as I can.
Yeah.
People generally are not comfortable. Non-white and white people, I have found, are not very comfortable with that term. But
that's why I use it. I want to make them uncomfortable, especially the whites.
I agree with that wholeheartedly. Would you say your view for anyone, whether they're white or non-white, but specifically white people, who allege that they're doing so-called anti-racist work, if the result of what they are doing is that non-white people are not suspicious of white people, that they probably are practicing racism, white supremacy, or at least reinforcing it?
That's a very interesting argument. And again, I think it's something that probably black folk are going to have to figure out. I remember years and years ago talking with a friend of mine, a black activist in a black revolutionary organization back in the 70s. And him saying to me, he says, you know, we know that there are some good white folks out there who are on our side, you know. But the problem is they don't represent very much in white America. They don't have much of a following. They are exceptions. They don't have much of a constituency. If we bring them into our neighborhoods and allow them to take part in our demonstrations, then it will make our people think that they have more white friends than they really have. And therefore, we have to say to these folks, we appreciate your good sympathies, but the fact is we can't really let you work in our neighborhoods because our people need to keep their guard up. That's pretty much what you're saying, and I have a lot of respect for that point of view. I think that the real test, I remember years ago having an argument with one of these white anti-racists, And he said to me, the test of a white anti-racist is his black friends. And I said, no. The test of a white revolutionary, a white anti-white supremacist, is his white enemies. I said, you go out there and make white enemies. You make them uncomfortable. You blow their world apart. You challenge their unions and their admissions departments and all the rest of it. You will make white enemies. And then you will find that black people will come and be your friends. As I found, you know, when I stood up in the factory and denounced the privileges of my trade, I didn't do it to win the approval of black folk. I didn't do it with the agreement of black folk. I didn't do it because I wanted black friends. I did it because I thought it was the right thing to do. And I was certainly pleased afterwards. The black folk came to me and thanked me and let me know that they appreciated my efforts and were supportive of me. But I was interested in making white enemies, not black friends.
I want to correct me if I'm wrong. I just want to make sure I understood what you said correctly. You said the test of a so-called white anti-racist or any white person who opposes white supremacy is not whether or not they have black friends or non-white friends or how many of them they have, but their white enemies, the numbers,
exactly,
the suspected racists that they have upset,
right,
that they are generating conflict with.
Exactly.
Very interesting. Very interesting. Have you, in the work, because you said you speak mostly to white people, have you seen any evidence that white people are going to stop practicing racism, white supremacy?
I see an occasional individual. See, what I see is, my project has been for years. See, I think for whatever reason, this society occasionally produces people who are called white, but who really don't fit in with what it means to be white in this country. They just don't quite feel comfortable with that. They don't want to live behind walls. They don't want to take advantage of things they did not earn. I mean, I don't know where they come from. It's a mystery, but there are some. There always have been some. The problem is that they grow up thinking they're crazy. How can you possibly reject the privileges of whiteness? What is the matter with you? Why would you want to hang around with those other people who are the victims and so on and so forth? And so they think they're crazy, and sometimes they're even made crazy by the pressures on them. What my project has been for years is that I'm not trying to win over more white people to anti-racism. What I'm trying to do is to get those so-called white people are in their hearts, don't feel that they're white, but can't quite figure their way out, to understand that there may be hope for them, that they may be able to break out of a white club. They are not alone. They may find themselves another community of people like them who also don't fit in with whiteness, and that it's also possible, if there get to be enough of them and they become visible enough, they may find that even the black folk will, you know, might say, well, these are different, and we might be able to deal with these folks. But that's not what it's primarily about. I'm trying to bring these people together and let them understand that there are alternatives to the white club. They are not easy. They are not obvious. But with a little bit of effort, or a lot of effort, they can find them and they can find each other and they can feel better about it and about their lives. Now, does that make sense to you?
I want to make sure that I'm understanding you correctly. Initially, you said that occasionally you see an individual or two, and that these people are not comfortable. They don't fit into the so-called white club, system of white supremacy, and the things that you're supposed to do to maintain that system, and that your work is primarily, focused on letting those white people know that you do not have to follow this. There are things that you can do to resist this, and you can find other people, other white people who also are working to resist this and form your own
community. That's right. Exactly. And that it may not turn out to be made all of white people either. They may find some others, but that's maybe down the road. But yes, they will build a new community of the people. Instead of the people who accept the white club, they will build a community of the people who challenge the white club.
Okay. It sounds, your answer sounds as though there's not a whole lot of these white people who are rejecting the system of white supremacy, the white club. It sounds, at least to me, you can correct me if I'm wrong, it doesn't sound like there's a lot of evidence that white people are going to discontinue their membership in the system of white supremacy. Is that correct?
I think I would agree with you on that, but I would add that it doesn't require a whole lot. That is to say, the strength of the white club is that it is able to pretend to speak for all whites. Once that illusion is broken, not one or two, that's not enough to break it, but once there's enough whites, people who look white but don't act white, the white club could very well start to come down. Let me give you an example. You know, in the period of abolitionism and anti-slavery, a number of the whites in that movement, they acted against the system. It's not the difference between the abolitionists and the general run of the northern population, which was also anti-slavery, is that the abolitionists were willing to break up the society over it. See, they went into the churches and denounced, broke up church services and demanded that we hear the grievances of the slaves in the South and break our ties with the southern congregations. They went into politics and demanded that every political figure opposed fugitive slave law, and they stood on the, you know, the common in Framingham, Massachusetts, and burned the Constitution of the United States in public because it was a pro-slavery document. You see, and that small group of people agitated and stirred up the country and created such trouble for the rulers of the country that they became an important part of the struggle against slavery. They opened up some space. They created some opportunity. And then, of course, it was the black folk themselves in their actions during the Civil War who were the main force in bringing down slavery. No question about that. But these whites who would not make their peace with slavery were part of what created the space for the black folk to do what they have to do. I think that in a certain way, you know, that kind of possibility, you know, I mean, I know some folks in western Massachusetts that do what they call a cop watch program. They go out in police cars, in marked cars, with video cameras and radios over, and they walk around and they document the misdeeds of the police directed against black folk. Now, these are white folks who are doing this, or so-called white folks who are doing this. I think in doing that, they may open up some space for black people to develop a powerful movement. And I would also say, by the way, that I think that it was not them that invented this. I have noticed that whenever the cops stop somebody in a black community, people stop and watch. I think that in doing that, they're already bringing to bear their own presence to try and restrain misdeeds of the cops. Well, I think that, I mean, that's a good thing to do. I think when these white kids, mostly youngsters, do this, there's a group in western Massachusetts, there's another group in Arizona that I know of, I think in a way they're taking a little step out of whiteness. Now, I know that the next week after they're not on that cop watch program, they go back to their regular jobs in their schools, and they're mostly regarded as white. I understand that. But I think in doing that, they're taking a little step out of whiteness, and they may be opening up space for black people to develop a strong anti-cop movement, which I think we would agree would be a good thing.
If you could give the non-white people who are listening to the program, if you could give them five things that you think are vital in understanding the system of white supremacy.
Well, what I'd say is this. White supremacy is developed historically, you know, and in a certain way, while people of color are the direct victims of white supremacy, the poor and non-property holding whites are the indirect victims of it. That is, whiteness does not bring freedom and dignity. It is a substitute for freedom and dignity. It is the consolation prize. It is the ability of the mean, degraded, downtrodden, oppressed white man who has no say in his life and no influence in the country as a whole to tell himself, well, however bad I got it, at least I am white and therefore I am better off than the others. And I would say that it is probably useful for people to bear in mind that the system does not originate out of a sort of a natural inclination of people grouped together on the basis of color or anything like that. but arises out of a historical development of a system of slavery and racial oppression in which it was necessary to find somebody to keep the others down. I mean, you know, it seems to me one of the truths of this world is that while, you know, some people may want to be slave masters, nobody ever wants to be a slave. And the problem of slavery is how to keep the slaves down. Well, in the United States, it's the ordinary whites that performed that function historically with some black assistance. And I'm sure you know that. That I think it's probably useful to bear in mind that this is a system which arose historically, that the operation of an unjust system depends on its maintenance, and that, you know, they should think of it in those ways, in the same way as I try to think that white is not a matter of color, but is a matter of social position, of which color is the marker. In the same way, the system of white supremacy is not about innate, inborn hatred, although that certainly develops. It's about, after all, you know, they did not bring black folk to this country in order to discriminate against them. They brought them over here to grow sugar and tobacco and rice and cotton. If they had wanted, if they didn't like black folk, they could have left them where they were, not bothered them at all. They brought them over here to put them to work. Now, once they put them to work, the problem was how to make them keep working for next to nothing. Well, that's where white supremacy comes in. But when you think about it, while white supremacy has certainly been vital in keeping down the mass of the dark-skinned people of the world, not just of America, it has also kept a whole lot of the white folks in this country enchained to a system that is no friend of theirs either. You know, you look around you at the life of most so-called white people in America, it is not what I call a good life. It is not a life filled with function and purpose and happiness and joy. America is a country of very unhappy and angry people, and they can't figure their way out of it, neither the black ones nor the white ones. And I think part of it would begin to figure out what function this white supremacy plays in upholding this system. The second thing I would think is that people ought to be able to think about, look beneath appearances and look down under into essences, you know? That is, try and understand what people, judge people by what they do, not what they look like. Now, by all means, don't drop the suspicions, because, you know, I don't say judge it by what they say, I say judge it by what they do. But I think that that's probably also a good idea, right?
What was that? That's a good idea.
Learn to judge people by what they do.
Oh, gotcha.
Not by what they say, but also not by what they look like. Judge them by what they do.
Results. I think that's an
well, okay.
One. But I think that's the same thing, a different way.
All right. Anyhow, I mean, those are, you know, those are seems to be some things. Bear in mind, you know, the capitalist system does not know money. I mean, does not know color. It knows money, but it doesn't know color. If it relies on color, it's because that's the way it keeps itself in power.
Again, I've concluded that we are in a system, or I guess we're in agreement. We have concluded we're in a system of white supremacy, and I feel that's the dominant factor on the planet. I wanted to ask you...
Well, excuse me, but let me ask you this then.
Mm.
Because I assume that by a system of white supremacy, what you mean is not simply the exclusion of black, dark people from the country clubs. I assume that what you mean is the maintenance of the dark-skinned peoples of the world as the world's ewers of wood and drawers of water, as the laborers, as the people who dig the gold and the copper and the uranium and grow the coffee and the sugar for somebody else's wealth.
When I say white supremacy, I mean specifically the definition I gave at the beginning of the program, global system of people who classify themselves as white and are dedicated to mistreating and or subjugating everyone who is not who they claim.
Right, but when you say mistreatment and subjugation, what do you mean by that? I presume you don't mean just refusing to let them marry your daughters. I presume you mean keeping them in the fields working.
It means, when I say that, I mean that the white people who practice white supremacy, we are in charge. We will decide.
In charge of what?
the non-white people. We control them in all areas of people activity and what they are going to do.
To what end?
What they are not going to do.
To what end? For what purpose? Do you agree with what I said before, that when they brought people from Africa to this country, it was to grow, it was not to, in order to hate them or mistreat them in general, but to put them to work, growing sugar, tobacco, cotton, and rice?
Do I agree with that?
Yes.
I don't know. I was not here then.
And you read. You know you're a scholar and a student of history. Why did they bring them here?
Again, I was not here. I have found that it is not constructive for non-white people to engage in discussions on motivations for why white supremacists.
Well, you tell me your discussion. What do you think? Why did they bring them here? That's a simple question. Why did they bring all those ships and all those millions of people over here?
I do not know.
Well, then you ask me what people should do. I say people should think about that.
Yes, sir. Do you think? And I actually wanted to give our listeners a chance to ask a question or two before we wrap up.
All right.
They can jingle at 347-215-6071. I wanted to ask you if you think one of the principal activities of the white people who practice white supremacy is deceiving non-white people. Do you think that's true?
Yeah, many of them, sure. They got people who pretend to be friends. Throw the rock and hide your hand. That's an old bit of folklore, right?
I have never heard that one, but I will.
Well, there you are.
Do you think it would be constructive for non-white people if they're speaking with a white person and there is a breakdown in communication, misunderstanding of what's being said between that white person and the non-white person? Do you think it would be constructive and logical for that non-white person to suspect that white person is practicing white supremacy?
You asked that an hour ago, and I told you, by all means, hang on to your suspicions.
Okay.
I'm not asking for your approval. I am not struggling against white supremacy in order to gain your approval.
Mm-hmm.
I am struggling against white supremacy because I think it's the enemy of all people on the planet who want freedom and dignity and a good life, and I include myself in that number. I'm not doing what I do as a favor to black folk. If it benefits them, that's nice. But I'm doing what I do because I believe that oppressing somebody else helps keep me in chains, and I don't want to be in chains, and therefore, to the best ability that I can, I don't want to take part in the oppression of others. I will not fasten the chains on myself. I will not fasten the chains on myself by participating in the oppression of others. You don't have to trust what I say. I'm not asking you to at all. I'm not asking for your approval. I didn't ask to come on this show. You asked me questions, and I'm answering you how I see it. I think that the worldwide system of white supremacy and enslavement of the Earth's majority of the labor force, which is black, brown, yellow, and red, is evil. It is threatening to destroy the planet, not just the people of color, but all people around the Earth. I think the system has to be stopped, and I think as long as people are poisoned by color superiority, they will always, and I'm talking about white people here at the moment, they will never be able to fight their enemies. I don't believe that the enemy of the ordinary white man is the black man. I think the enemy of the ordinary white man is the rich white man and the rich black man to the extent that he's part of it. That's what I think. Now, you may not agree, but I'm not fighting, as I say, I'm not opposing white supremacy out of some, I'm not a do-gooder or a liberal or even a Christian. I'm opposing it because I want to overthrow the evil system of robbery and violence and exploitation and immiseration that is threatening to destroy life on the planet. And I know that 4/5 of the planet is made up of the dark-skinned peoples of the Earth. And I know that they are me, although we have a different color skin.
I want to check the switchboard to see if we have callers. Would you share with our listeners, could you tell them some information about your website, racetrader.org, and your book as well, if you want to plug that as well. But could you tell them some information about that and what they'll find if they go to check out your website, please, sir?
All right. Well, on the website, it's racetraitor. That's not trader, but traitor, race, traitor.org. They will find a selection of some articles from a journal that I was involved in editing and publishing that went on for a number of years And some articles they may find interesting and some they weren't. There's also a list of the tables of contents of back issues, but the articles. And also the address on the website is wrong. And so they... All right, that's one. And then my book is a discussion. It was called How the Irish Became White. And it was a history of how a group of immigrants to the United States from Ireland, who were themselves the victims of oppression in Ireland, the Catholic Irish, an oppression by the British and by Protestants that was in many respects similar to the oppression of African Americans in the United States, how they came to the United States and learned about whiteness and learned how to take their place in it and found their place in it. So in a certain way, if my book on the Irish is the story of how a group of people become white, the journal Race Traitor is a discussion of the possibility of how we might succeed in unwhitening people.
Outstanding. We have a caller. You're on the line. Go ahead, and if you have a question or comments you want to ask Professor Ignatiev, go ahead.
How to take their place in it. And found their place. So in a certain way, my book...
Hello? Caller? I can hear you, I think. Maybe they're just listening. I will check another caller. If you're there, go ahead and ask your question. If not, I'll get someone else, because we have a couple people who've called in to ask questions. Okay. I'm going to go and get the other person. They're going to ask their question. As soon as I put them online, it'll be 770. Give me 1 second, and I will put you on the air.
Hello, I'm still here. I'm waiting for whatever.
Hello?
Hello?
770?
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Okay. Mr. Ignatiev, it's been very interesting. It's been a while since I've read your book, but I have the following question. Is it your experience that white people have to compete to actually be white? I have found, having traveled around Europe and other parts of the world, that white people in one area may not be considered to be white people in another area. So how do these, does the system, let me ask you this, does the system of white supremacy produce non-white people out of formerly white people, and does it make white people out of non-white people?
Well, it certainly does the latter. It certainly makes white people out of non-white people. After all, nobody was white before they came to America, right? People in Europe had fair skin, but they couldn't have been white because the category, you know, didn't exist for anyone. So people become white in America by gaining access to the privileges of whiteness in this country. And so that seems to me that was what my book was about, was how a group of people, you know, and from one country who had no understanding of what whiteness was and learned it when they got to the United States. I mean, I think, see, the point that you're making is that it's very much a social definition. You know, they tell that story about old Papa Doc Duvalier, you know, the longtime ruler of Haiti. And some American reporter asked him what portion of the Haitian people are white. And Duvalier says 90%. So the reporter thought this was a problem in translation, asked the question again. And Duvalier says, yeah, 90%. So the reporter said, well, how do you define white in Haiti? And Duvalier says, well, how do you define white in America? And the American reporter says, well, in our country, anybody of any... Or he says, how do you define black? He says, well, in our country, anybody of any known African descent is black, the famous one drop of blood. And Duvalier says, well, that's the way we define white in Haiti. And it seems to me that what's going on, see, is what was the function that was served by making some people into whites? Well, it was because they could be used as policemen to keep the black folk working in the fields. In spite of, you know, our host saying that he doesn't know about that or doesn't want to answer that, it seems to me it's fairly evident that the reason for racial oppression is to make some people continue to work for the profits of others. For the profits of whom? Not the ordinary white man, but the rich white man, and these days some rich black men as well. And that's how I see it. And so these poor whites, you know, work as the tail of somebody else, the caboose on somebody else's train, keep the black man working in the fields. And what do they get from it? They get the ability to pat themselves on the shoulder and say that they're white. They get access to better jobs, better careers, no doubt about it. They get real privileges. But what they also get is they give up the right to shape their own futures. They get the right to live in a country which has gone to hell in a handbasket. They get a society of war and impoverishment and insecurity and anxiety. That's what it means to make people white. That's why I'm against it.
Wouldn't it, under this logic, be logical for white people to compete with each other to maintain, to remain white and against other white people? So, for example,
sometimes, sure. Were you thinking of a specific example?
For example, I mean, if you look at historically, let's say World War II,
mm-hmm.
You had the people that called themselves white people that called themselves Germans,
mm-hmm.
Fighting people that called themselves Slavs in Russia.
Right.
Germans did not consider these Slavs white people; wouldn't even accept their blood for transfusions.
Right.
And vice versa. So they were fighting each other over who's whiter.
Well, see, what I think they were fighting each other over was who's going to own the land and the wealth, and who's going to be made slaves to work for whom.
Well, that depends on your interpretation of Marxism versus National Socialism, which I, at the end of the day, I equate both of them. But them competing to exploit the Africa and the other
mm-hmm.
areas of non-white.
I think that's right.
The point is, even in today's society, wouldn't it be logical for white people, understanding that they do not want to end up like black people, like you said, no one wants to be a slave, to compete with each other to be white? So, for example, I'm a Nordic person, so therefore I'm saying that you, white person from Italy, is not really a white person, and so on and so on. And I'm a Jewish person. No, you're not a real white person because you are a so-called Jewish person. Et cetera, et cetera. It seems like white people are competing with each other to be white. Is that still the case? Hello?
770, are you there?
Yes, I'm here. Hello?
Professor Ignatiev, are you there?
Well,
let me check to make sure he's still on the line there with us. Hope his cell phone didn't lose signal. Hold on 1 second. Very interesting. I had another caller call the line, 773 area code.
Mm-hmm.
That person was next in the queue, and both that caller and Professor Ignatiev's line is not there anymore. I'm not sure what happened. I will keep an eye on the switchboard if they return so he can answer your question. And 773... if you are listening, if you jingle back in, I will make sure that you get your question answered as well. Hopefully, Professor Ignatiev, he'll give us a jingle back so folks can get their last couple questions answered. I'm not sure. Not sure what happened.
Well, at the end of the day, if the white race wants, if Ms. Ignatiev wants to abolish the white race, it would seem to me that logically, it would be logical to exacerbate these differences between the different whites, so that non-white people can basically sit back and say, okay, you guys compete over who's white and who's not, and in the meantime, we'll sit in the bleachers and wait. Maybe you'll wipe a few of us or a lot of us out in the meantime doing that, but the logic of the system is such that eventually it'll have to destroy itself. That's how I see it. I mean, maybe completely incorrect, but that's really where my question would go at the end of the day with Mr. Ignatius.
How do you see the system destroying itself? I'm going to make sure I check to see if I got those callers back so he can answer your question himself. But I'm just curious, how would the system destroy itself?
It's simple. The system is based on function at the end of the day, and color is incidental. You know, system could have been selected based on anus size or eyebrow size or whatever. So color is the incidental biological factor that they use in order to maintain a system of oppression. Now, if that is so, then anyone that does not want to be a slave and wants to join in not being a victim would have to compete to become white. So historically we have seen people like the Irish, for example, or the Jews, or the Italians, or the whatever categories you have, is trying to escape their status as being non-white. And becoming white, especially coming over here to the United States, and being and enabling to become whites because there was a broad mass of very dark-skinned people here that already had been brought here, which is a different situation than in Europe, where even today, white people see color. So, at the end of the day, if everybody competes with each other to avoid being non-white, that means that they have to compete with each other to becoming white. And white. And that would be the seed of destruction of the system. You see?
I wanted to point out we have 773 and 301 on the line. I don't know if Professor Ignatiev has called back. 773, are you there?
My Lord.
Okay, perhaps someone being disruptive. I think it was 301. Are you there?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Did you have a question or a comment?
Well, I have a question and a comment. I felt the way he was explaining was very, it was not constructive at all.
What did you, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Great, what you were saying?
I was just going to ask, what specifically did you feel made it difficult to grasp what he was saying, or what do you think he could have done that would have made his comments more constructive in expressing himself?
Well, I don't think he was trying to be constructive at all. I just felt that he was trying to be a person who was trying to be confusing, and most white supremacists are.
Mm-hmm.
So the whole thing about metaphors and war stories, and you know, you all got into a kind of a, you know, debate about I'm not a alleged white supremacist, and I kind of felt, well, maybe you should have said, you know what, maybe I think this is not constructive, so I think I will get off the phone with you.
Mm-hmm.
So for me, I just felt he was trying to be a person who was dodging. You was asking very logical questions and not getting a logical answer.
Hmm. Well, I tend to think white people, generally speaking, if you're asking questions about racism, white supremacy, they are generally not going to answer directly. I think there are a few instances. I would have to obviously go back and listen to the broadcast to pick out specific things. There are a few things he said that I felt were constructive, but I felt there was definitely a lot more resistance and him not being direct in answering questions. I even felt just there should not be any conflict. That's my personal view.
Yeah.
No white person should have any conflict, any problem, any hostility. They should, as I said, they should be Mr. Rogers in speaking with any non-white person about racism, white supremacy. Answer that person's questions in a calm and courteous manner to the best of your ability, and try to be concise, particularly if the non-white person is requesting that you be concise and to the point so that everyone can easily understand what's being said. I don't think that's asking too much. I do recall him saying that that was asking too much. Generally, I'd say if a white person is saying that, they're probably not going to be of very much help to, you know, sharing constructive information. I felt the few things he said were interesting, but, you know. Did you have a question from Professor?
No, I have a question. My question to you is, I really don't have a – well, let me just say this. You're one of my favorite hosts that you you do, and one of the things I particularly like is that you do ask precise questions and do not go off the topic and try to – when the person that's on the show, they – try to go off and go into something else that doesn't even make any sense or has anything logically to do with the question. But one of the things I do like, I like listening to you a lot, is because you keep on the what the conversation is about, what are we trying to do, and where we want to go to. You know what I'm saying?
Mm.
So my question, huh? Go ahead.
Oh, go ahead. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
My question to you, as a, someone who is a victim of white supremacy, did you find your conversation with Dr. Knowles constructive?
Generally, for my programs, it's a little difficult for me to gauge whether or not they're constructive because I'm participating in the program.
Right.
So often I have to get a little distance from the program to go back and listen to it, and then I can make a I mean, it's never going to be objective because I am participating, but I can make a more accurate assessment of whether I think anything constructive was in the program. I have certainly listened to programs that I've done, and I felt, well, this wasn't very constructive at all. I don't think there was any information that was shared that would be helpful to non-white people. I would need to do that for this program just based on recalling what he said and the course of the conversation. I think he said a few things that were constructive. I know I would definitely share his comments about anti-racists and gauging them not by the number of non-white pals that they have, but gauging them by the results and gauging them by the number of enemies that they are generating amongst white people. I think that's constructive. I also thought his comments about the older non-white people, older than 55, being more informed about racism, white supremacy, because they've been subjected to a more obvious form of
white supremacy,
and the younger non-white people perhaps not being as informed. I thought those were pretty constructive. That's about as much as I could say. I definitely think he could have been more helpful. I definitely think in terms of efficiency,
Very low.
I could definitely dig out a few things that he said, but in terms of efficiency for the amount of time that he was here, it could have been much higher. I can definitely think of other white people that I've talked to where I feel they were much more direct, much more substance. I feel like I would really have to dig to get morsels. There are some there, but I'd really have to dig much more than I would like to for a discussion on white supremacy.
Well, I have two more questions, and Lee, I know that the program is almost over. I have a question. Do you have some Neely Fuller Jr. or Dr. Crescent on when you have these so-called white people who practice anti-racism?
Repeat that, please, sir.
I said, do you sometimes like have? I don't know you all. I know it's probably not constructive to have them, Neely Fuller or Dr. Wilson. Mm-hmm. And has some of these so-called anti-racism white people on there?
I have not. I have not done that at this time. I know when I was scheduled to have Tim Wise on the program last month, I actually spoke with Dr. Welsing and requested that she come and join that conversation as well. She declined, and she said that it's been her experience that when a non-white person attacks, that was her exact word, attacks a white person or is perceived to be aggressive in how they're questioning a white person, the non-white people get hostile. They are not cool with a black person or a non-white person being aggressive in questioning a white person, particularly a white person who alleges to be an anti-racist. And I have observed that a lot myself, so I really couldn't argue with her. I have tried. She said she didn't think it would be constructive. I'm not aware of any such conversation taking place where a so-called anti-racist was present with Mr. Fuller or Dr. Welsing. I do think that would be interesting, but I'm not aware of any program that has taken place where that's happened. I would be very interested in checking it out, though, if it did go down.
Right, because one of my dilemmas that I have with these so-called anti-racist white people is that they have these great books out that everybody goes, like you said, Tim Wise is the Elvis Presley, like you said. I would like to see their knowledge against someone who is just as knowledgeable in white supremacy, racism, and white supremacy, and how would they say, well, maybe I need to do this, or maybe that, or maybe this, or see where their knowledge lies among someone who is well versed as a Dr. Welsing or a nearly full of junior.
I too, like I said, I would be extremely intrigued.
Yeah, I definitely want to, because I was like, one of the things I was wondering about that you all never have that on there, and I understand why you not have that, because people, again, like you said, white people get very, very, very hostile and almost into the point of where they want to actually try to put harm on you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I know with Mr. Wise specifically, I don't know if everybody got an opportunity to check it out, but Mr. Wise sent me two very long emails prior to coming on the COWS. He sent these emails in May. He was on the show in June.
June the 1st?
I'm sorry?
Was that June the 1st that program aired?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
He, in those emails and in other writings, he has talked about Dr. Welsing. Specifically with Dr. Welsing, I get the sense he does not like her at all. I posted those emails online, and they're also on a blog. I will try to put those links in the chat room. Actually, if you click on the link for that show, if you look in the archives, if you click on the link for that show, I put it as a comment. There's a link where you can go and check out the letters that he emailed me prior to coming on the show, and I believe he mentions Dr. Welsing and Mr. Fuller in those letters, and I've seen some other posts where he has written about both Dr. Welsing and Mr. Fuller, and I got the impression that he does not like Dr. Welsing at all.
But I would expect so, because if you look at Dr. Welsing's writings, it's logical, and it follows, it has a certain linear about it.
Mm-hmm.
And when you deal, one thing about that I've noticed about people, well, excuse me, white people, that they can't deal with the truth very much when it comes to themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And then when you talk about something about genetics, that really blows everything about this whole racial concept of that whiteness is a political structure. No, it's not. It's a white supremacy. It's survival of genetics. And if anybody would dispute that, it's, to me, anybody that's white and they didn't know that or expected to know that, there's something wrong with them. And the way he was trying to, the older gentleman knows, did not see it as that way. He kept saying the darker people, and then he kept saying about how the white people wanted to take over and make them work. No, this is about genetically survival. And I totally agree that Dr. Welsing is right on point when she says genetically survival, because they're only 10% of the population, correct?
That's what I've been told, yes, sir.
Right, so if I'm 10% of the population and I want to survive, therefore I'm going to create a system that will have my genetics go into the next generation and possibly the next generation. As long as the system is there, I think I have a pretty good chance of survival a couple of centuries. So let's cut the construct and, you know, the whole game with the wordplay and the and, you know, definitions of what's going on. But I like, again, say I like you're one of my favorite hosts. I just want to let you know you do a wonderful job as keeping on the subject as much as possible. And at one point I thought you was going to get indignant, but you pulled yourself back. So I just wanted to let you know you're doing a wonderful job and keep up the good work.
I appreciate it. Are you a non-white person?
I'm black.
Right. I appreciate it. Thank you for tuning in. If you feel the programs are constructive, share them with friends or whomever. And, yeah, I appreciate the support.
Who's the next person you're about to have on? I pretty much heard everything on the – heard just about all your talks and just about everybody, just about all the people you have I've heard. Do you have anybody new or anybody that's up and coming or –
I know Dr. Welzing. I spoke with her on Memorial Day, and she suggested that I get Eula Biss on the program. Eula Biss is a white woman, I believe. I have not asked, but I'll make sure I do so. Eula Biss is a white woman. She is a writer. She wrote a book called Notes from No Man's Land. Dr. Welzing, again, recommended that I get her on the show. This book is about, in the 1900s, white people started putting up black telephone poles, and white people got upset about these black telephone poles, and they started cutting them down. Eventually, they started lynching and castrating black men on these black telephone poles. Eula Biss wrote a book about this. Dr. Welzing said she saw her on television doing an interview about her book, and she said it was very interesting. So she told me to get her on the show. I contacted her. She was really cool, and she said she would come and chat. So she's scheduled to be here on July 22nd. That's 2 weeks from tomorrow. I believe hanging out in the chat room is Jessica Pettit. She called the show when Dr. Moore was on the program. I believe she admitted to being a racist and says she's working against it. I believe we're trying to work out doing a program on Monday, next week, Monday at 4 p.m. Pacific. I guess that'd be 7 p.m. Eastern. And Dorothy Roberts, she's a professor at Northwestern. She's written several books. I know I'm reading her book right now, Killing the Black Body. She talks about specifically, she used the term white supremacy in her book, about how the system of white supremacy has worked to control the reproduction of black people specifically. She talks about this from slavery all the way through current times. She and I think are set for August the 9th.
I want to ask you one more question before I go. Do you do any, like, anything on sports or stuff that has to do with athletics or anything like that? Because I'm very curious to hear what people have to say. I mean, I read Dr. Crescent's book about ball games, but I was hoping that anybody had to come on in depth about sports and how it relates to the different positions on each, I mean, different positions that the brown balls play, like, you know, like football or basketball, and what sort of symbolics that it has.
I haven't looked at any program specifically dealing with sports, although I would love to do so. Just from a lot of different perspectives. The one thing that I guess is close in the ballpark is there's a non-white male, Trevor Von Eden. I've been in contact with him since December. He's doing a comic book on Jack Johnson, the black heavyweight champion, early 1900s. He's doing a comic book on his life, and very interesting comic book. You can check it online.
Yeah, because the reason why I asked that, because I'm a former athlete.
Okay.
So, you know, I tried out many pro teams, also played football and basketball, and just the dynamics of the game itself. If there's a game inside the game on the field and in the NFL and the NBA. So I was just wondering, you know, just like, you know, she talks about, you know, the different ball games. And, I mean, I coming from just being an athlete and training and getting myself prepared to play those sports, There are a lot more than, you know, that I could shed a light on. If you do have that particular segment, you know what I'm saying? Because I find it very interesting that, you know, the, hello?
Yes, sir.
The football player that died, Steve McNair. And he played quarterback for the Tennessee Titans. And
yes, sir.
And I don't know if you're a big sports fan, which I am. I'm also into training. So I come at it a different way as far as things, because I really look at athletics as seeing why white people really have this fear of genetically not being annihilated. So that's my high take on it. But I don't want to hold you up, so I just want to let you know that you're doing a great job, and I'll probably be calling more often on the show.
Please do. Please do. I appreciate the support, sir. I thank you for the kind words. Again, if you think it's constructive, share it with your friends. And if I can, or if you have an idea, if you run across, you know, somebody that you think is knowledgeable on this, that you know.
Well, actually, I was hoping that somebody made a show. I know y'all don't. I know y'all talk. The most thing I noticed y'all talk about is the ninth of all things is sex and not having sex with white people, and you talk about how that's going to change things. I would like to get more into the actual game itself, football, because I noticed that as any position, you know, the black quarterback is one of the few positions that's in America that has not yet reached the pinnacle of being that one black athlete that you would have to say, like, you have your Tom Brady's, you have your Brett Favre's, your Peyton Manning's, but you know, when a black guy, you know, sort of gets it, who has the athleticism as a Michael Vick, they tend to say, well, he's not playing the game right. That's not how you're supposed to play, you know.
Mm.
So you get into all these wordplay. He doesn't play from the pocket, and you know, you hear stuff like, well, skill positions, and quarterback is not considered as a skill position. It's considered as a cerebral position. Like I said, I study athletics. I talk about the NFL draft, some of the things they say. You know, he has a big butt. He has big thighs. He can run.
Mm.
You know, it's a lot of psychological things that make the players take one-lick scores, tests. Depending on what position you are, if you don't get a high, especially quarterback, if you're a black player, and you don't get a high score on the one-look test on your quarterback, then this thing about switching your position, or you don't have enough intelligence, you know. So there's a lot more things that I, you know, would like to get in. If you do have any ideas, I'd like to get more in-depth in the ball games, because I see it as a different at a different level when it comes to, you know, preparing these kids for the next level.
Mm.
So I don't want to hold.
Oh, not a problem, sir. If you want to shoot me an email, my email is HUGG.
Hold on,
oh, yeah, yeah. 619, you're on the air, too. I just hang in there. You have a pen, sir?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. It's HUGGYBEAR.
Is that AR?
Yes, sir. EAR.
So I'm going to read it back to you. It's HUGG. Y D E A R.
B as in bear. B as in bear. B E A R.
Okay.
At counter-racism.com.
Got you.
Yeah, that's me. Please feel free to shoot me an email if you want to talk more about this. If you have suggestions, you sound pretty knowledgeable about it yourself. Perhaps you should be writing a book on this or doing a show on this.
I thought about it, but I really didn't have the construct of doing it. I mean, I hear you all. I know that you have other people who do this stuff. But like I said, I mean, I'm so dressed in the NFL so much, I have tapes of combines. I have so many tapes of combines. I have what the kids, how high they jump, how fast they ran, how can I make them faster. See, I'm a trainer. So I have to make sure these kids do a certain amount of on their interview. It is an interview. I mean, they test how high you jump, they test how fast you run, they test your intelligence. They do a psychological test. They test your body fat. They test if you have any defects, everything to the from head to toe. And you can pretty much tell who are the athletes and who are the guys. They say, well, this guy is a hard worker. This guy is an athletic guy. And you can hear some of the words they say about black athletes and white athletes, well, non-white people and white people, basically. And and you got basically these non-white people. So you have some non-white people on the panel, and you have white people. And what they do, and they evaluate, well, I don't think he's smart to play in this scheme here. I don't think he can run this fast. Or so you're basically looking at a guy. It's basically they make you take your clothes off. They weigh you in front of people. People watch you. And it's basically what you call a slave auction. And you figure out, you know who the slaves are, and you know who the indentured servants are. So I don't know if Dr. Wilson or Neely Fuller, or because they pretty much come at a construct of where it's a global system of white supremacy, but at the same time, like you said, that entertainment that I really never talk about, because I talk about the movies or comics, but sports is entertainment.
For sure, for sure.
And we don't delve in the entertainment part, because as you look at the sports, you can pretty much tell what society is going to be like when certain people are, like certain players are looked upon as great players, and some people are looked upon as being crybabies, and some people are looked upon as being not good players. It's just the whole construct of what a microcosm of society is. So, but I have your email address. I have it here, and I'm going to repeat it to you again. That's HUGGYBEAR. It should be counterracism.com. Is that one word, or is that a dash in between there?
There's a dash in between there. Thank you for catching that. HuggyBear@counter-racism.com.
That's a unique name. But anyway.
Yeah, it has stuck. I've had that for a while, so.
Have you ever played any type of sports growing up, or?
Basketball was my thing. I didn't like play professionally or at college or anything like that. But I just I played a lot. I watched a lot. Up until the Ron Artest thing, basketball was pretty much my my heroine. I didn't do alcohol or anything. I just watched basketball all the time until the whole melee happened with Artest in Detroit, and I felt racism was all over that, and that completely severed my love affair with NBA basketball. So,
that happened, and that just gave the, you know, just the that was an excuse to say, well, I need you guys to stop looking, you know, as acting thuggish and need to put on. So that just gave them more idea. I was hoping that y'all had a chance to talk about the Michael Vick situation, the dog, which Dr. Wilson. Said something about, you know, about the two Greek, I think it's not Greek, Roman, about the two, about the dogs raising them and stuff like that. She did talk about that, but, and the whole Mike thing, and a lot of people say, well, friends of mine say, well, why did you say the white people killed him? I said, they did. And in factuality, they really killed him. And if he, like you said, if he knew anything about racism, white supremacy, he probably would not be dead. So, I mean, the point you made at the beginning is a valid point in saying that if he would have known what would happen, he probably wouldn't be in the situation he was. And people were like, well, it's his father's fault, but you can't blame a victim of racism, because he's going to do the same thing to somebody who is someone that looks like him. So
sure.
I can't blame him. He's a victim of racism. You know what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
So a lot of people were saying, well, that's really mean to say. I said, well, it's not really mean. It's the truth. Because no one that I know of, and this should be an example to any black person or any people on the planet who is non-white, this is an example of how they took the construct of white supremacy and made a person who were black into white in a matter of years. So,
yeah, Mike for sure a victim. As I said, ironically, his public funeral today. I wholeheartedly agree, and I really believe that. Like I said, I spoke with a lot of other victims the day that it was announced that he had passed away.
Yeah.
I think all of us agreed if he had been more informed about racism, white supremacy, we suspect he would still be here. For sure, a victim. I think even Quincy Jones, I was told, I was not near television, but I was told Quincy Jones said that more than anything, Michael was a victim. I was kind of stunned that was even reported to me, but if it was said, I wholeheartedly agree, and kudos Quincy Jones. But yeah, I definitely, I know enough about sports. I wouldn't say I watch as much anymore, but I know enough that I definitely would have an interest in doing a program or two, or more perhaps.
I have one more question. Before I go, you all, you had this young lady on. I remember you had this young lady on there, and I think it was the yellow Manny was on the phone with you.
Mm-hmm.
And you was talking about her when she was making this guy who said he was a white Hispanic, and you both were talking about her, about saying, well, how come you didn't step in and say something?
Mm-hmm.
I thought that was so funny because I didn't think, in the sense of it, it was funny, but I was like, damn, she's sitting there, and I know you all knew she was lying, but she wouldn't admit it, you know what I'm saying?
Mm.
And you were like, well, if you say so, if you say that he's a white Hispanic, then that's what he is. And you both were laughing in the background, and I thought that was so hilarious, because she was like, yeah, he's a white Hispanic. And I'm saying to myself, there's no such thing as a white Hispanic. Why would you even say anything like that? I mean, it just sounds so ridiculous that you would actually think these two people who are non-white to go, yeah, he's a white Hispanic. That's almost like saying a white South African. You know what I'm saying? But so I was like, come on. I mean, you made a mistake. Hey, I'm part of the system, and I wish, you know, more white people would say that.
Mm.
So, and really get it out there. I benefit from this system, and I don't want to get rid of it, period. And I understand that. I'm not mad at you. I wouldn't want to get rid of it either if I got advantages to anything.
For sure. And if I enjoyed it. I mean,
right.
I tell white people that consistently. I think that would be helpful. If they, so I think we told Kelly from Carl W., if we had white people who were just being honest and saying, I'm a white person, I participate in the system of racism, white supremacy, and I enjoy it. I have no intention of giving this up. This is great. We had David Allen, admitted white supremacist. He is a professor at the University of Washington. He said, and I quote him directly, he said, being white is like being on high-octane caffeine all day long. His direct words, he said this on video. If more white people were saying that, great. I mean, that right there would at least let the non-white people know what you're dealing with. That would be fantastic.
I mean, funny thing about it, the young lady, I think her name is Engineer 7 or something.
She might be on the line. 619, are you still there?
I am here.
Oh, there you go.
hi. I was, you know, I listened to some of your stuff, and you're also one of my favorite ones, too. And you was talking about I think you were supposed to do something with Francis Wilson about white people adopting black kids, and I know you had some type of technical difficulties. And I wanted
were very strange ones, yes.
Yeah. I wanted to go back to, if you can remember, I wanted to go back to a segment you did with a young gentleman about. You was telling about white people, and you was telling me that you had a problem with non-white males.
That I had a column with non-white males?
No, a problem. I'm sorry. You said that I didn't.
A problem with non-white. Oh, sure. Yes. Uh huh. Yes. Yeah, absolutely.
You.
Mm-hmm.
And you said that you did at one point you didn't have. You didn't find them attractive? Is that correct?
That is correct. That is not that I didn't occasionally find them physically attractive. But their value to me, they were extremely undervalued, and I thought that what I sought was a validation from the attention of white males that I could not get from black males.
And you said your father was into the, I guess you said you always knew that you were into, I think you was telling me that he was into the Black Panthers or something. Is that correct?
He was very centered on opposing racism for that time period, yes. There had been a functional Black Panther unit in the place where we lived at the time. He was definitely going to become one of the prominent members, but it never panned out. But, yeah, he would have, absolutely.
Well, may I ask you a personal question, if it's possible?
Sure.
You said you have a you was married at one point to a white person, to a white male, and then you had a child that is who is of mixed descent.
She's non-white, no doubt about that. And yes, I was so-called married to a white male. Yes.
Since you have switched over and you know have someone found out you were a victim and now you're seeking for justice for non-whites all the world over the world, how do you interact with her? I wanted to ask that question. I listen to that often. How do you interact with her?
This is really, I'm going to have to disclose some parts of information that I had thought I would probably not have to disclose. Because the most important part of it is that she is extremely aware of white supremacy, extremely aware that she is non-white. If she were to get on and make a two-sentence statement about the nature of white supremacy, it would be, I think, more constructive than anything that I could ask of any of my so-called adult neighbors on the street on which we live. And yet, she is mildly mentally disabled.
Okay.
But that is because, and yet she still would have more to say that would be concise and constructive about the system of white supremacy because she has been around it her entire life.
Right,
she
but I'm
very, very clear. Yeah, go ahead.
What I mean is like, I mean, I know the, I'm talking about the interaction with you, just between you and her. I mean, I mean, since that... Hello?
Yeah, I better let you finish your question. Your question.
Oh, since you all, since you have, separated from the person you was married to, and
mm-hmm.
how do you interact, and how do you explain that relationship, and go into depth, and why I did the things you did? You don't have to go into a in-depth question, but just the interaction of you all, you two, and the decision you made to separate from your white counterpart.
So you're talking about the interaction between my female offspring and I. Is that the question you're asking?
Yes.
Yeah. She sees him very, very seldom, and that is a good thing. It is not something that has been opposed by her father. He has mistreated her significantly. She understands when she asks me questions about it, I answer her honestly. I do not berate her with it, but when she asks me questions, I ask her honestly. She has specifically asked me if her father was a white supremacist, and I have always answered her that I suspect that he is one.
Okay.
She will use, yeah, so there it is.
I have enough. May I ask another question if it's possible?
Sure.
Okay, you also did another, if you can recall, you did another, program, I guess last week or sometime, I don't really recall. Gus was on the phone with you. Matter of fact, you was talking about, I think, hair texture and color.
Yes.
And you was asking, you was talking about why more men are more seeking in the justice of white supremacy, and you was telling about how it would be a sort of a genetic thing where men are more aggressive and trying to seek to get that. I'm probably not making any sense.
I'm not real clear on the question you're asking. I sure do want to answer it. I'm just not clear on what it is.
Well, it was about, I think it was about, I think Yellow Manny was on the phone. I'm talking about something. I'm probably misconstruing something else. It was talking about, you was talking about how people treat darker skinned non-whites, right?
Mm-hmm.
And,
yes.
And I wanted to ask you, what hue of color are you?
Okay, let me see if I can think of someone whose color I'm close to. Maybe somewhere with Tempest Bledsoe, maybe between Tempest Bledsoe and Felicia Rashad. I mean, just a medium brown.
Okay.
Yeah.
You're saying that you get treated much better than when you're by yourself or something like that? I don't know.
Yes, I do.
And is that... And that's the since you, I have a question. You said you do, right? Do you find that to be very...
I believe I do.
Yeah, do you find it to be very strange?
Extremely. Extremely. It was extremely confusing to me at first. For the first, not confusing, but just really interesting. The first, say, 6 months that I had a sustained relationship with... my black partner, who's very, very, we were, you know, just normally affectionate, not out of the bounds of what you would expect anyone else to do, white, Hispanic, however, in public. And what I found so strange was the hostility that we would get. And I've since had time to reflect since the last program that, in fact, the hostility comes from both the males and the females when he and I were together or are together, as opposed to when we're apart. He finds that people are less hostile to him when he's walking around by himself, and I find that people are far less hostile to me when I'm by myself or with other non-white females or black females than when we are together. And we're not doing anything. We're not obviously not loud. We're just sitting and talking constructively and quietly, maybe being mildly affectionate, and people go berserk.
Okay.
And they're... Yeah, very, very strange. And the hostility and the strange behavior is so much more pronounced than it ever was many years ago when I was walking around with this white male, which you would suspect would be the reverse. So I found that really, really interesting.
Oh, okay, because I was like, wow. Because I said, I don't even get that. I give more white people being more afraid of me than anything.
When you're by yourself?
Yeah, even if I'm with my girlfriend, I get more people being afraid of me than anything. That's why I said I found that very interesting.
Well, as you're contrasting it with what? You get more white people being afraid of you when you are with your girlfriend as opposed to when you are...
Both. I mean, because I'm like 6'3", dark skin, 225, bald, I was shaved. So, I mean, I really don't get that type of reaction. I was wondering, I was very curious to hear, you know, your side.
Right. You know, and I think I did misspeak, because actually I think I did misspeak. The difference, the dramatic difference in treatment is of me, not of him.
Okay.
He gets hostility everywhere, but I think he does say that he gets treated better when he's with me. No, that's true. He says he gets better treated when he's with me, although he's not treated well in either circumstance, but he gets treated better, a little bit better. Better meaning that females seem to pay him more attention when he's with me. Non-white and white females pay him more attention than when he's with me. And most people would say he's a very attractive male, very attractive. But he gets more attention from females when he's with me than when he's not, but that he's not really treated well whether he's by himself or with me. But the big contrast is with me. When I'm by myself, there's a big difference. I'm treated much better by myself than I am when I'm with him.
Okay, because I was, you know, like for me, it's like the totally opposite. I don't know, is it just my height or am I bigger than most people or of the average man? So, like, I was just wanted to see.
He's 6'5", about 230, so I don't know what to say on that.
Yeah,
because so
I'm like 6'3", I'm assuming he's dark-skinned.
No, I would say he's more. He's a little bit darker than, say, Boris Kodjo, but I mean, he's definitely a black guy. Yeah.
Okay. Because, like, for me, I'm like, I'm more of like on the Wesley Snipes hue.
Okay. Well, that would probably explain it. Much more intimidating. Much more intimidating. From what I have read, much more sexually desirable by white females.
And I reason why I don't mean to cut you. I'm sorry, but did I cut you off?
Mm-hmm.
Huh?
No, that's okay.
I apologize.
In terms of your hue? No, in terms of your hue, but no, go ahead.
No, what I was going to say is probably they probably see him in most, and they probably get this whole thing. Well, he's light skinned. He's they don't consider him as being what is the word I'm looking for? Hard. Or he's respectable, so I can pretty much do anything. You know what I'm saying? And not be afraid because he doesn't look like a criminal. I mean, I'm assuming these things that what people are thinking.
Right. I mean, I'm sure that this is very clear that the darker you are, the more severely you're treated. But that's not even I think that was the last subject of our show. So I don't have any quibbles with the fact that if you are darker skinned than him, that you receive more mistreatment.
No. I didn't say I receive much more treatment. I see people much more scared of me, and I get I get good treatment because people are scared of me.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Okay, I see what you're saying.
Because I really don't. When I walk into a place, I really don't. I get served. People really pretty much stay out of my way. So I was very curious because I'm like, I don't get that. I mean, I get people see me and they just, people just go on the other side of the street. I mean, white or non-white. I mean, I tend to have a face, if I don't smile, then people look at me differently. But when I smile, then people kind of come and they're kind of being more warm to me. If I don't smile and if I'm just walking down the street and I don't have a grin on my face, people tend to look at me and maybe cross over or maybe even not say anything to me.
See, now that's an interesting statement because I remember when Yellow Manny was on the last program that Gus and I did, he was stating that a lot of times we as subclassified black people will place the category of not being mistreated into the category of being treated well. And so that because someone doesn't go out of their way to hurt you or abuse you,
right?
I'm wondering whether or not that's something that we should place in the category of being treated well. That's just not being severely mistreated. You know what I mean?
Right, I got you. I'm just saying, like, I don't see it overtly. I don't think they would do it in front of me because of it. I mean, usually when someone tries to mistreat me, I would say, look, hey, I think I'm being mistreated here. I would like to have better service. And I just think that I know that Yelly Manny said that, sometimes black people don't know when they're being mistreated. You know what I'm saying? I heard that part he was saying. And I
agree
as well. And
right. And that has been my experience with the primary male that I've been dating is, over the last few years, is that he doesn't know it either. I have to point it out to him. He doesn't know it because he doesn't know what it's like when he's not around.
Right.
But he doesn't even see it. I have to point it out to him. I'm like, when you're not here, these people come so much more quickly. I get free baskets of chips. They take right. off. They give me discounts. He doesn't even know.
Well, I'm assuming you are, when you're by yourself, you're an attractive-looking female, so therefore you're going to get the attention.
Yeah, I do get treated better by the males, but that's definitely true. But I did reflect upon what the difference was when we're together and we're being served. After that phone call, I did reflect, how do the females treat me? What's the difference between a female server when he's with me and when he's not with me? And definitely the female servers are more hostile when he's with me.
Right. I get you. And sometimes, I go to, I could be, I remember being at a nightclub and I was just sitting on the wall and this white female came up to me and said, she was hitting on me, and she said, "Do you not like white women?" I said, "No, I do not." And she proceeded to say, "Are you racist?" And very, and I was surprised. She was very calm.
Mm.
And she said, "Well, maybe I can persuade you."
Wow.
I'm sorry. I know I'm not supposed to laugh, but I'm sorry. That really was funny. I'm sorry.
It's okay. And I was like, I scratched my head and I looked at her kind of funny. I said, "You're not going to get upset?" She said, "No, why would I get upset?" She said, "I wouldn't get upset." I said, "I can't force you to have sex with me, and I can't afford," and I thought that was the weirdest thing. And that bothered me for the rest of the night. That, like, just messed up my whole night, because I was expecting her to get hostile and you are racist and you're no good. And she said, and this is what trips me out, she said, it was funny, she said, "Well, I just find you attractive, and I understand that, you know, I understand the situation, and I understand that. But," she said, "you know, here's my number. And if any time you want to, I can persuade you she said, "I would be happy to do so. And I kind of looked at her, and I gave her a card back. I said, "No, you've been wasting your time." And I just kind of walked away scratching my head like, what just happened? Usually when white females approach me, they either get, "Well, who are you, and why are you not, are you a racist, and what are you doing?" And I even had a friend of mine that I'm real close. She's a white female, and I hate to do this because you all talk about not being argumentative, and I'm a very argumentative person. So we get in this whole. She says, "I feel very comfortable around black guys." Now, like the story said, like before, like for me, I had sexual relations with a white female, and you're not supposed to, correct?
Mm-hmm. It's not correct, but so did I. Go ahead.
And the reason why the only reason why I did have sexual relationship with this woman, because I wanted to see what it would be like, and I found out it was just the same. So she was very upset at me. Because every time she's an admitted racist, in my opinion, but that could be another story. So she, every time we was at a club, and I was saying to her, like, you know, every time we get into these heated discussions about race, and I said stop the foolishness. At any given time, if you did not want to date a black person, you would just stop dating him. If you felt that your family was against him. And she got so upset. She was so mad at me. She left the club. I thought it was so funny. I didn't mean to be an argumenter at a club, but it turned out to be that way. But mostly white females get upset about not dating, but dating, saying that I don't date white women. So it's just weird.
Yeah, that, you know, and that right there, I wanted to make, that was my main reason that I had called, to really co-sign on this particular dislike that Gus was talking about, that he had, he surmised that Tim Wise has for the work of Dr. Welding. I find that to be consistent with the strange dropping of calls that whenever her work comes up, what happened with the interview that I was supposed to do with her, in terms of not being able to reach her three times at a number that I know was hers. And I have come to the conclusion, the preliminary conclusion for right now, that is the heart of the issue, and that is the one that white people, the white people who practice white supremacy, are least willing to get to the heart of the matter about. That's the thing they're least willing to talk about. And I know that there are a lot of counter-racist scientists who I don't seek to argue with, who do not believe that there is much value in discussing the why of why white supremacists do what they do. But I do know that in Mr. Fuller's book, who is also someone who seems to not put as much emphasis on understanding why they do what they do as, say, Dr. Weldon does. And interestingly, I find that females seem to be more counter-racist science attempters seem to be more interested in the why than males. But even in Mr. Fuller's book on page 159, he makes it a point to say that to know and understand a person's ultimate objective, with ultimate objective in bold, is to know and understand what is most worth knowing about that person and why they are doing what they're doing. And, you know, I think when it comes down to the sex, whether it's genetic annihilation or just sexual access, I think that hits so close to the core of why it is that they do what they do that she, I think, is her work is the most opposed. And I think it strikes a when I say opposed, I mean by these supposed white anti-racists. So I thought that you really hit something there. I think that white females, and that one white female in the club who did not seem to get emotional about the fact that she didn't seem to be interested in calling her back, they're getting more refined. She's like, there are getting to be increasing numbers of black males who don't seem to be getting emotional about whether or not they had an opportunity to have sex with white females. And whereas that used to emotionally bother these white females, I think that people like that have the responses that you gave her are now becoming subjects of study. And I also wondered whether or not the way that Dr. Ignatiev responded today, the kind of emotional way that he presented himself, whether or not that was calculated. In other words, was he trying to see if he could get Gus to be emotional in response? Is this a new stage in the refinement of white supremacy to try to find where the new emotional buttons are for black people? Or if, in fact, what's going on is that people like Gus, their work is being studied before they come onto these shows, before these interviews. And now that non-white people have a language, a technology, hello?
Yeah, I'm right here.
Am I still on the air?
Yes.
Okay. Now that non-white people have a technology of language that doesn't make it as easy for white people to practice white supremacy, what you find is a mirror of what used to happen. It used to be that the language works for white supremacy. Usually the language works for white supremacy. So non-white people know they're being mistreated, and when they can't get any satisfaction, when we can't get any satisfaction, we just get loud and start screaming and get emotional and get arrested.
Right.
But when you start being codified and machine-like, and the language isn't working for white people are the people who get emotional because the language isn't working for them.
Right. Is Gus there?
Yes, sir.
Oh, okay. To piggyback what you said was, I find very interesting that you would say that because a lot of my friends, like, for instance, they say, well, when I talk about racism, white supremacy, they say, man, I really don't want to hear that. I just don't want to hear that. And I kind of laugh, and I say, well, man, that's what it is. He said, every day you wake up talking about that because that's what everybody else, that's what the other side is talking about. In every, like you said, in nine areas, they talk about that. So back to what you were saying about the codified language, when I was listening to Mr. Knowles, I just couldn't really. I just felt that the. Did you listen to the program, Seven Engineer?
Yes, most of it. Most of it. I did. Yes.
I just felt that he was not precise. He didn't ask the questions that you precisely ask Gus T. Renegade, or he answered your questions because he kept saying, "Well, I'm not going to answer like the way you want me to answer," and it just seemed like he was trying to dictate what the format of the show was, and Gus told him what the format of the show was. I need you to do this. Can you speak in a clear, precise manner? I need you to ask the question, the answer in a precise answer. And also, I felt that he was trying to give him questions to answer to say, see, you agree with me. And I just thought that he handled himself very well, and just to be on just to say this, I wouldn't him invite him at all. I mean, Hello?
How come, sir?
Yes, no, I'm here.
It's because, like, he felt, and this is just my point of view, he felt that his, the way he was doing things, this is right, and I'm not participating in this white supremacy because I took myself out of it, and you know, that's a lie in itself, because you have the choice to take yourself out or put yourself back in at any given time that is convenient for you. That's a lie. You know what I'm saying? I'm not saying that some of the things he was saying were untruthful, and meaning untruthful, meaning that if he's saying that things that are untruthful, and then you have people who don't know the language of white supremacy will believe that. You know what I'm saying? So that gives him, somebody that's listening to this, say, well, he's right. He can pull himself out of that, just like John Brown got himself killed. No, John Brown got himself killed because he wanted to get himself killed. At any given point that he felt that depression was bad, he could always go back into the white supremacy system and be safe. He chose to do that. And he wouldn't say that it was a choice. You know what I'm saying? Because he's still saying that it's not a choice. He was still saying that I'm not this. I'm not a white supremacy. Just like when you ask the question of 10 whys, when he used the example of selling drugs, of selling crack cocaine. Remember you asked him that question?
Yes, sir.
And you said, well, I just like a person who sells crack cocaine, I stopped doing that. But in the same sense, and if I'm saying this correct, you were saying that you're still a part of the system. If you're still a part because you have a choice to choose to not deal with the system or to go back in the system when it's convenient for you. And I just felt that he was doing that the whole interview. And also, he was trying to dip and dodge in between. He was saying some things that were very offensive and also very confusing. So that was just. Hello?
Yes.
Yeah. Yes. I did agree that Gus handled himself very, very well in the interview and did not allow himself to be taken off track from following the logic. So I suppose they're going to have to continue doing more studies on Gus and those of us who are, you know, experimenting with this codified method. But I always enjoy Gus's shows. I didn't find much of constructive value in what Mr. Ignatiev said, but I did find the show overall extremely constructive because I found the lengths to which someone who could clearly communicate in a simple and precise manner would go in order to not be clear and precise.
Right.
So for that reason, I found the show extremely constructive. But I know the show has gone way over, and so I definitely wanted to make sure that Gus got a chance to take other callers or say whatever else he wanted to say. But I've enjoyed talking with you, and gosh, thanks for your contributions to my day today. I'm gonna sign off for right now.
Okay.
All right.
I constantly listen to your shows at least listen to each show literally 10 times, so I can probably quote. That's why I brought up the whole thing with the 10 whys when he brought up the whole description about me selling. I'm not in the system anymore. Because if he tried to use the example of a person selling crack cocaine and he stops, he's not part of the cocaine. But at the same time, you're still a part of it because you damaged so many people by selling it to other folks.
Mm-hmm.
Because you stop right there doesn't mean the damage doesn't continue.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what I remember when I were when I listened to the thing with Tim Wise and. And you said that he was which was a great analogy, that he was the Elvis Presley of counter-racism. And he didn't take too kindly to that at all.
He agreed, though.
He agreed, but I also, like I said, I can tell in his voice he didn't take too kindly because he probably said, look, I'm just going to just accept that because I know that I have no course of action to even respond to that because it's true. So he was like, in his body language, not his body language, in his voice, in his inflection of his voice, he was like, well, you're right. And he kept saying, you kept asking him, shouldn't non-white people be skeptical of white people? It should be a healthy skepticism. Well, the word healthy, we have no quarter for what definition of healthy you're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
So that right there was just saying, okay, I'm just going to say this word because I know I can get away with it, and the people who are listening to this show don't have a clue or a clue of what the word healthy means. And it's just saying, yeah, people should have a skepticism at just across the board.
Mm.
That's something that I picked out of. So
another white, and I would encourage anybody who is checking this broadcast out, the emails Mr. Wise sent to me prior to coming on the show, very interesting. Anybody, if you want to check those emails out, you can just go and click on that particular episode and look in the comment section. There's a link. You can go to thecode.net, and you will see those emails. They are online, and they are long. He sent two extremely long emails where you can see he does not like Gus at all. So I would definitely say check those out if you're interested.
Did he ever give you a reason why he never liked you? I mean,
it's very clear in the emails.
I mean, I know it's very clear, but when he wrote those emails, what did he actually say to you that you got out of that email that was constructive?
I wouldn't necessarily say constructive.
But
I would say interesting.
Interesting.
The crux of it was around me saying that he is an admitted white supremacist and an alleged anti-racist, that he felt...
Can you hold on for 1 second?
Mm-hmm.
Can you hold on for 1 second?
Yes, sir. Again, context of white supremacy, Gus T. Renegade. Finishing up, we have a few minutes left in the program. I will share what Mr. Wise said and probably wrap this one up soon. Thank everybody for checking out the broadcast. Please check out the blog.
Hello, I'm back, sorry.
Oh, yes, sir. I was just telling people to check out the blog, racism-notes.blogspot.com. But, yeah, Mr. Wise, he didn't think, his exact words was he thought it was unethical for me to say that he was an admitted white supremacist, even though he admitted on the program that he is. He also felt that it was not being completely honest to say that he is an alleged anti-racist because of all the work that he does. He went very much, like I said, it's two very lengthy emails where he, you know, broke down all of this. And in the emails, he evidenced that he had went and listened to several of my programs. I think he listened to the program with Dr. Welzing and some of the other shows. Just, you know, it was a lot. It's more than I could quote here, but that was the crux of what he was not pleased with me about in the emails. And he did, in my view, he did a very good job of not conveying the same hostile tone that he had in the emails when he was on the program, which I was kind of expecting, but it didn't happen. So I agree totally about the Elvis thing. I definitely think he was not pleased about it, but it was true. And at the end of the day, you know, even though he talked for 5 minutes to explain himself and all this, he had to admit it's pretty true. It's a pretty accurate description of what's happening here. And I do hope that the non-white people, the whole reason that I do the programs talking to these white people that I suspect, every last one of them, Professor Ignatiev, Tim Wild, well, he's an admitted white supremacist, and Farrell Winfrey and everybody else who's been on the program, I suspect that they all practice white supremacy, perhaps in different ways, perhaps in the same ways, but I suspect that they all participate in mistreating non-white people, and I suspect that they all do so consciously.
Well, I'm sorry. I would totally agree with that because, I mean, come on, let's be realistic. I wouldn't even want to give that up. I mean,
yeah. That, and I think some of them have said that. Michael Bradley and other people have come on and said that. And I hope that in doing these programs, non-white people will become more informed about the very deceptive nature of the white people who participate in this system of white supremacy, even the ones who claim to be anti-racist, so that our understanding will advance and so that we'll be a lot more skilled in dealing with these people and just white people in general. I hope that's the benefit of these programs. We'll have to see if that happens or not. The broadcast is about to shut down. You have my email, is that correct, sir?
Yes.